Hello, and welcome to the ION training series. This program is designed to familiarize you with the ION console and its capabilities, allowing you to quickly create dynamic shows. So what is the ION? Well, the ION is actually one of ETC's newest consoles, and it's part of the EOS family of consoles. The entire EOS family, including the ION, was designed from the ground up to be a 21st century lighting control console for 21st century lighting rigs that, as you probably know, contain a lot more than just dimmers. Contains things like color scrollers, complicated moving lights, and even color-changing LEDs. So the goal here is to have a console that can control all of that with the maximum ease of use, and that's what the ION can do for you. So, now that we know what the ION is, let's get started. Now, because ION may be new to many of you, I would like to take a moment to familiarize you with some of the operating conventions of the ION console, because it may be a little different from consoles you've operated in the past. First, I want to talk to you about how ION addresses channels. Older boards, or channel-based boards, were very, very simple in how they addressed channels. Basically, you'd have a channel, you'd assign a dimmer or dimmers to that channel, and when you brought the channel up, you'd get lights. It was very, very simple. However, with the introduction of multi-parameter devices like moving lights into theater and control boards, we suddenly now had devices that required lots of control. And if you had a moving light that needed 12 different attributes of control, you were suddenly chewing up 12 of your channels, so you could quickly blow through all the channels you had available on your console. With an ION, that's not the case. A channel is a channel, and it doesn't matter if it's one dimmer in the channel or if it's some fancy new multi-parameter moving light with 60 or 50 parameters, it's still just one channel. So that's going to make it really easy as you go to organize your channels on your ION console. Another thing I want to talk about is how the ION records cues. Certain consoles that you may be used to using operate in like a preset style mode, which would be like an expression, or in a tracking style mode like an obsession. The good news is that the ION is a move fade desk, and it kind of works like both. So whichever one you're used to, the ION has you covered. And one other thing I wanted to talk about is how you enter commands into this board. With an expression, say it was a direct access board, you would just type some commands and the board would do it. On the obsession, you had a command line. Well, you may have noticed that this board has a command line. So for all of you expression or express users, you may be a little wary of the command line. However, well, you'll be happy to know that a lot of features from the expression and express line, the direct access commands, have been moved into the ION console. So that quick access is still there, even though this board has a command line. So even though the ION is new, I think you'll find it to be quite familiar. So you have your ION console. Maybe you've just taken it out of the box. And one of the first things you're going to need to do is make sure that everything's plugged in. So in this chapter, I'm going to show you the back of the ION console, all of the necessary connections that you may need to make to get the ION ready to start working. And once you do that, you're ready to go. All right, so let's take a look at the back of the ION console. And the connections that you need to make are kind of arranged in groups. All the way to the right, these connectors are mostly your data connections. So the all-important DMX connections are right here. There are two ports of DMX on the ION console, and typically your first port is the one that you'll use. And the DMX cable is one of these 5-pin XLR connectors, and they just snap right in, like so. The next thing you want to plug in is right next to that, and depending on the manufacture date of your ION console, you'll either see a video display that's labeled dual DVI display, and your ION console would come with a splitter like this, and you plug the splitter into that connector, tighten down the screws. Now it's important that once you put this splitter in, go ahead and leave that plugged in and tighten down. These are the connections that you can make to your two monitors. Or your ION console may actually have two of the individual smaller DVI connectors and you don't need the splitter, you just plug a monitor into each one. Moving further to the right, we will see an area where you can connect peripherals to your console. So this is where you would plug in things like your mouse, and it's a USB type connection, and the keyboard. And when you're plugging in your mouse and keyboard, remember that these are USB type devices, so you probably will have, maybe even have trouble finding those old PS2 style connectors. So these connectors over here that have the little graphical mouse and keyboard are not the ones you're going to use. You want to use the USB. Also in this section is an Ethernet connection. So if you have Ethernet in your theater, this is where you'll do that. And those are standard RJ45 type connections. That clicks in like that. And if you have a fader wing that is not physically attached to your ION, you will need to connect that to your main desk with a USB cable. One end goes here, and the other end can go to an available USB port on the back of the desk. And then the fader wing requires its own power connection, and this is a wallwart style power adapter that you can plug in to your power source. And then finally, once you have all of your peripheral and data connections, you're ready to connect power. And the power section of the desk is located all the way to the left-hand side if you're looking at the ION from behind. And the power connection is a standard computer-style power cord that plugs in here. And then there's a power switch for the power supply, and what you want to do is turn that on after you've connected your power and plugged it into the wall. So once you've made all the connections and you have the power cord plugged in and the power supply switched on, you are ready to come to the front of your ION, hit the power button, blue light will come on, your ION will start up, and as soon as it's finished booting, you're ready to get to work. In this section, we're going to cover the layout of your ION console face panel. Now, one of the great things about the ION console is it's available in a myriad of different configurations, but one part of every ION console is exactly the same. And in this chapter, that's what we're going to focus on, and that's the main programming section of the ION console. So let's take a look at that. Beginning over here on the left side, all the way at the top, we have the power button. So this is what you will press to power up your ION console. Directly below that is a USB connection. You can use a little flash drive or a USB storage device if you want to save your show files or PDF printed files offline. You can do that here with this USB port. Below that is your Grandmaster and your blackout key. Moving to the right, the main playback fader pair is right here. That consists of a crossfade pair as well as two buttons, a go and a stop back button. Moving further to the right is a large section of keypads, and these are grouped by function. Right in the middle is one of the most important keypads that you'll probably be using, and that's the numeric keypad. So it's got your 1 through 9 and your 0. So as you're programming numbers or entering values, you'll be using that keypad. It's also important to remember about this keypad is that it has the plus, minus, and through keys, as well as the all-important clear key. So remember that about your numeric keypad. To the left of the numeric keypad is your record target keypad and the attributes of those record targets. So this is where you'll have your Q button, your sub button, and of course, the record button. So that's over here. To the right of the numeric keypad is a command keypad. This is where you have buttons like full, out, and the enter key. Now above those three keypads, we have a couple of different keypads that house all of the frequently used functions. So a lot of the functions that you'll be accessing quite a bit on the console have their own dedicated hard keys in this section of the console. Above that, we have our soft keys and our built-in LCD display on the ION face panel. As far as the soft keys are concerned, S1 through S6 correspond to those soft keys. And what's great about the soft keys is that the commands that are mapped to them can change depending on the context or what display that you're in. And those functions are displayed right here on the LCD screen. And each button is mapped to a corresponding function. There's a more soft keys hard key, and by pressing that, I can page through the various commands that are available to me in this display. To the right of the soft key, we have a large keypad over here. This keypad is dedicated to controlling what's happening on your monitors. So this is changing what is showing on the monitors as well as moving around the monitors with the page up, page down, left and right arrow type things. Directly below the display keypad is a wheel. And the wheel is primarily used as a level wheel, but it's a multifunction wheel, and we'll talk about what else this wheel can do as we get into future chapters. Across the top of the ion console, we have the non-intensity parameter control section. This consists of four encoders and a small bank of buttons. The buttons primarily really only control what page the encoders are on, and they're grouped by function. So you have focus, which would have pan and tilt, things like that, or color, as well as image. The encoders themselves turn to affect whatever parameter I want to control, and they're also a button. And when we talk about controlling non-intensity parameters, we'll talk about how those encoders work. So that is the general layout of your ion face panel. In this section, we're going to talk about faders on your ion console. Now, the concept of a fader on an ion console may be a little bit different than what you're used to if you've programmed on previous boards, because we use the generic term fader to refer to a slider that can be moved up and down on the console. Now, typically, these are, on a console like this, would be used as a submaster, but it's important to remember that faders on an ion console can be more than just a submaster because they're programmable. And in later sections of the training, we're going to talk about some of those specific things that faders can be used to do. Now, the ion console, of course, is available in a lot of different fader configurations. It's really up to you how you use them. You can actually attach up to six of ETC's universal fader wings on either side of your ion console. For example, you can have them physically attached, where the ion is a single unit with fader banks physically attached to the console so it moves as a single piece. And if you have space considerations, you can use the 1x20 attachment, and the console then is only 19 inches wide. Or you can leave the wings unattached, and they can be on an umbilical with a USB cable, and this provides ease of mobility and some flexibility in how you arrange the faders or move them between various ion consoles. So, as you can see, all of the different configuration options using the faders on your ion console provide for a very flexible way to set up the console to your needs. Okay, let's take a brief moment to talk about the external display setup on your ion console. The ion can be configured to use one or two displays. For our purposes in this training, we're looking at a dual display setup, so I want to take a moment just to go over real generally what you're looking at on these displays. Here on my left-hand display, the vast majority of this display is taken up right now by channel information. So this is where all of my information I can see about my channels. Down here along almost to the bottom is the command line. And that command line is always there. It's important to know where the command line is because you'll be referencing it quite a bit.
And all the way at the very bottom is the selected queue display.
On my right-hand display,
the top half is my playback status display with a list of the cues in my system.
Right in the middle is my fader status, and down at the bottom is an area called the CIA, and the CIA, or Central Information Area, is actually like an extension of my face panel, so there are functions and controls in here that are context-sensitive, and we'll cover what's happening in the CIA in another chapter. Now, on the face panel of my console, up here in the display key area, I have a button called swap, and what that allows me to do is swap the left-hand monitor for the right-hand monitor to suit my individual taste. I'm going to go ahead and leave it how I had it originally for this training. So that is, in general, the overview of the external display arrangement on a dual monitor ION. If you are using a single display with your ION console, you'll see a lot of the same information that you would have on the dual monitor display, but a lot of the information will be condensed. For instance, on this default display, the top half is occupied with channels, and the bottom half is occupied with a cue list. And using the swap key on the console, I can go through various formats. So I could go for this split screen. I could format and see a bigger channel display. I could hit swap again and get a larger cue list display, or the final is a half and half. In all three of these displays, the CIA is actually hidden. The ION will bring the CIA up if it's needed, but if you want to see the CIA on your own, you can mouse and click over to, in the lower right-hand corner, you can see this little up chevron sign, and you can click on that, and that will open up your CIA, and you can pin the CIA open, or you can let it automatically hide when you're not using it. So that is how your display will look if you're using one monitor on your Ion console. The dual monitor setup allows me to show you all of the features on the Ion console with greater ease. So for this training, we're going to go ahead and use the dual monitor setup. Okay, in this section, I'm going to go over in greater detail what you're looking at on your channel display. So let's take a look at that right now. On our left-hand monitor, remember the vast majority of this monitor is taken up displaying your channels. The default setup for the Ion is a combination display. It's going to show you what we call tiles, and it's also going to show you a table. And whether it's a tile or a table really depends on whether you're using a single parameter, like just an intensity channel, or whether you're using a multi-parameter, like a moving light or a scroller. Because if you remember on the Ion console, a channel is just a channel. It's one channel, regardless of whether it's one parameter or multi-parameter. But the console will display it differently depending on what type of light it is. So let's take a look at that. First off, you can see that our first six channels here are tiles. That indicates to me that these six channels are just intensity. So if I bring up an intensity on channel one, you'll see that channel one is highlighted and it has an intensity of 18. So intensities will always live in that box below the channel number as indicated right here in channel one. Now starting with channel seven, the format changes a little bit. This indicates to me that I now have a channel that has more than just intensity, and it's arranged in columns. So you can see I have channel number seven, and I do have an intensity column. So if I brought up an intensity for channel seven, it would bring it up just like it does here in the tile. But I also have an entire section here labeled color. And what I'm seeing here is that channel 7 has a scroller attached to it. So I can see very quickly what is happening on channel number 7. So there's not a lot of hidden information. So the table view makes it really nice to be able to see what's happening in your multi-parameter fixtures. After my scrollers, after channel 16, you'll see that we go back to channels that just have intensity, and therefore it's tiles again. So that is the default display of looking at channels. There's another method of looking at channels, and you can change to that by pushing the format key. Now the format key is in the display keypad. It's all the way to the left and almost to the top, second one from the top, directly below live. I'm going to hit format one time, and I'm now going to change to a display that is just tiles. So now I'm not looking at table view for anything, so I'm now looking at tiles only. This display is also zoomable. Actually, all the displays are zoomable, and I'll show you how to do that right now. By pushing and holding the format key, you can actually change the zoom level. And I'm going to go ahead and zoom in quite a bit. I would never actually run the console like this, but if it's 2 o'clock in the morning during tech, maybe I would. But here you can see that we have a greater detail of what's going on here in our tiles. Now notice the difference between, in this example, tile number 6, channel 6, and number 7. You'll see that there's a slight difference. Remember that channel 7 was my scroller channel. And you'll see that the tile changes slightly to indicate that, hey, I've got more than just intensity going on here. The lines bordering the intensity area are squiggly, and there's a little C down in the bottom of the tile to tell me that this channel has a color parameter associated with it. If I move to a channel like channel 101, you'll notice that again, it's a multi-parameter channel, hence the squiggly lines, and you'll see that my letters at the bottom have an F, a C again, and B. That means that this particular channel has the ability to do focus, color, and beam, so it means it must be some kind of moving light. But again, primarily what I'm interested in is looking at an intensity value that is going to show up there on channel 101. Now I'm going to zoom back out because it's not 2 o'clock in the morning during tech. I like to operate at a display like this where I can see about 200 channels. That gives me a nice overview. And then I can always go and format again back into my combination view where I'm looking at tiles and table view. So that is the overview of looking at channels on your Ion console. Okay, in this section, I'm going to show you another way that you can customize how you're viewing your channels using a feature called Flexi. There may be a time where, like for instance in this example, where we have our tiles for some intensity channels as well as some table, and then we have an entire row of channels here that say unpatched because I'm not really using those. So it would be nice if maybe my unpatched channels or maybe other channels that I really don't need to be seeing at this exact moment, if they would just go away so that I can focus on the channels that I am working with. Flexi allows you to do that, and there are different modes of Flexi, and they're accessed by using the Flexi key. The Flexi key is in your display keypad right in the middle, and it's labeled Flexi. So each time we push Flexi, a different Flexi mode will appear, and I'm going to go over those right now. The default state underneath my clock here, you'll see no indication of a Flexi mode, but once I push Flexi the first time, you will see that the first mode is patched channels. So what this is going to do is my display is now only going to show me channels that I have patched. Anything that's not patched, meaning there hasn't been a dimmer assigned or a non-intensity parameter light assigned to that channel is not going to show up on your display. So it's a nice way to condense that down. I'm going to push Flexi one more time and move into the next mode, which is called Show Channels. What Show Channels will put up on the display are all of the channels that have been recorded into one of my record targets, like a queue or a sub or anything like that. So literally, this is just the channels that are being used in my show. This is the most similar to what Express or Expression Flexi Channel was like Show Channels. Flexi again takes me to Active Channels. These are channels that have levels above zero. So if I go ahead and step into a queue that I had recorded, you'll see that any of the channels that came up in intensity are going to show up as active channels. And my next Flexi mode is something called selected channels. These are only the channels that I have selected and I'm working with. So if I on my keypad type 1 through 6, those selected channels are going to show up. So this is a way for me to quickly just look at the channels that I'm working with at this very instant. And finally, I push Flexi one more time and I will go back out to my default mode where I'm showing everything, including my row of unpatched channels. And that is how you use Flexi on your Ion console. In this section, I'm going to cover the command line on your Ion console. Now, what is the command line? Maybe a concept that's not familiar to you if you're used to using a direct access board like an ETC Expression or Express, but the Ion has a command line and it's important to know why it's there. The command line is the main programming interface on the console. The primary place you're going to find it is at the bottom of your channel display, but it's also duplicated in your CIA and also here in the built-in LCD on your face panel of your desk. So this is where you can see what's happening in the console at all times when you're working with the command line. So what is the command line? Well, on the Ion, the command line is the main interface to programming the console. It's where you basically type in all of the commands that you want the console to do. Now, the great thing about the command line is that you post commands to it as if you were just speaking English to an operator sitting at the board. But the nice thing about the command line as well is that you're able to go back and make changes to that before you actually execute it. So let's take a look at an example. Say I wanted to bring up channels 1 through 6 to full. I could simply type on my keyboard here 1 through 6 at full. Now before I push enter, I have the option of reviewing the command to make sure I have typed what I want. It's like, oh, well no, actually I've made a mistake. I only want channels 1 through 5 at full. So I can push the clear button and back up in the command line and change the 6 to a 5 at full. And now I look at it and I go, that's great. That's what I want. And I push enter and now the command has happened. So what I'm doing is I'm using direct access like an expression to post the commands to the command line. And when I'm happy with the command, I push enter and the console does it. So it's a nice way to get programming commands into the desk. The other great thing about the command line is that the console will store all of your commands. So maybe I didn't want channels 1 through 5 on at full at all, or maybe I recorded a queue that I didn't want to record, I can simply hit undo, enter, and that command is gone. So that's a great feature of the command line on the Ion console. And those are the basics of using the command line on your Ion console. In this section, I'm going to cover the QList display on your Ion console in greater detail. Remember, this is the upper portion of my right-hand monitor as I have this set up.
This is known as the playback status display.
And really what this is designed to do is give you a general overview of all of your queues and all of the associated parameters of those queues in your console. So let's take a look at how that display is organized right now. It's essentially a table. The rows down the side here are your queues listed in numerical order, and then the columns running across are all of the parameters associated with those queues. Now on your console, if you're using some of these parameters or not, they may not show up. We have this set up so that all of the columns are showing so that I can tell you where they are. This display is arranged in columns, and we'll start over here. The column all the way to the left is a column labeled queue, and this is pretty self-explanatory. This is just my queues listed in numerical order. Moving over to the right, we have a fairly large column that is called timing, and that timing column is divided up into sub-columns, and let's look at each one of those right now. We have separate columns for intensity up and intensity down, and your intensity up and down times will show here, as well as any delays that may be associated with those intensities. Next to that, we have three more columns that are designed for your non-intensity parameters, if you're running moving lights, for instance, and those are broken up by category, and those three categories are focus, color, and beam. So the focus, color, and beam timing will show up in their own column in that portion. And finally, the last column under timing is duration, and this is going to show you the overall duration of the queue, including all of the timing parameters, so you can see very quickly what that queue, how long that queue is going to take to run. The next column over is called flags, and this is the column that if any of your queues have any of these flags associated with them, they will show up here. What these letters mean are the following. The M stands for mark, the B is for block, the A is for assert, the P is for preheat, and the A over the F is for all fade. Next over, we have a larger column called attributes, and it's divided up into subcolumns. Those subcolumns are FW/HG. That's actually short for follow and hang. So if you have a follow or a hang time associated with the queue, it will show up in that column. We have link. If you have a queue that is linking to another queue in the queue list, it will show up there. If you have a queue that is looping for some reason, it will show up in the loop column. Curve, if there's a curve associated with your queue, the curve number will show up there. And last in this attributes, we have rate. If you've assigned a percentage to that queue to run faster or slower, that rate will show up in that column there. Next to that, we have a label. If you want to label your queue, all of your queues can be labeled, so that's very nice for reference. And last but not least, all the way to the right, is a column called external links. This is where any external object outside of the queue, let's say a macro or another queue in your console, is executed by this queue, that link will show up in the external links column. And remember, not all of these columns may show up depending on whether or not you're using these parameters of your queue. So that is the general overview of the queue list display on your Ion console. Right now I'm going to cover the area of the display that we refer to as the CIA, or the Central Information Area, on your Ion console. Now this is the area here on my right-hand monitor that occupies the bottom half of the monitor, and that's what is referred to as the CIA. Now what is the CIA? Well, the CIA is kind of like soft keys on steroids. It's an interactive extension of the keypad, and depending on what you're doing or what display you're in, this portion of the console might give you buttons to click, or fields to edit, or even colors to pick if you're working with some of your color-changing lights. A lot of the things we're going to talk about in the training will require using the CIA, so make sure you pay attention to that. let's take a brief moment to talk about a specific area of the CIA that you want to pay special attention to, and that's called the browser. Now, on your Ion console, the browser kind of takes the place of what would have been the setup menu on a console you may have used before, another ETC console. Let's look at where the browser is located. It's in the CIA, and in most cases, it is the right-hand side of the CIA. If the browser isn't there, I can always hit my displays key, and there's a key that's labeled displays in the upper right-hand corner of my displays keypad on my face panel. Once I hit the displays key, you'll see that the browser is highlighted, and now the browser is active. Now I can use my arrow keys in my displays keypad to move up and down in the browser, and I can use the left and right arrows to open and close any of the items that may be expandable or contractible. So let's take a look at each one of these, and I'll tell you a brief description of what each menu item is, but again, we'll go into them in greater detail. The file menu is, of course, where you will be saving and opening show files that you have stored on your Ion. You can also exit the Ion program or power off your console directly from the browser. You can access the setup functions of your Ion console from the browser, as well as the clear menu, where you can clear your queues or the entire show or reset your patch. That's all done from the clear menu here. The print menu gives you the ability to print various parts of your show. There's a utilities menu for cleanup or for other things, just a couple of utilities in there. There is a section of the browser that allows you to pull up lists of all of your record targets. Say you want to bring up a list of all the subs you've recorded, you could do that from record target lists. Same thing with virtual controls. You can bring up windows on your console that give you additional control into your console. And last in the list is a menu for network, and this allows you to view and alter some of the network settings on your Ion console. So that's the browser on your Ion console. As we go through the training, you'll notice that there's a lot of functions that we may need to go into the browser to use. So for our purposes in this section, we just want you to know where it is and how to move around the browser. Once you're familiar with the layout of your Ion console and the layout of your displays, you're ready to begin programming. So let's take a look at how to wipe your console clean and start from a clean slate. To do that, we're going to start in our browser in the File menu. So I'm going to go ahead and go to my browser, and the first item in the menu is File. I'm going to make sure that that's highlighted and hit my right arrow to open up the File menu, and I'm going to go down one to the File New. Then I'm going to hit Select, which is right next to my up arrow and above the right arrow. And the Ion console is going to prompt me and ask, do I really want to create a new show file? And I do. But the first thing I want to do is make sure that the patch 1-to-1 box is checked, which will signal to the console that I want to start with a brand new patch so that I'm ready to start bringing up lights right away. Once I do that, I click OK, and the console starts up nice and fresh, and you're ready to begin programming. But before you do, there are two important features that we want to mention. The first one is About. What About will do is give you information about whatever it is that you've selected. By default, when you press About, you're going to get about the Ion console that you're working on. This is very useful because you can see how many channels your Ion is using, how many outputs it's capable of producing, as well as software version and other relevant information about your desk. So to see that information, you can hit the About key, and the About key is right in the middle here in the frequently used function keypad. And when you hit About, your CIA will come up and it will tell you that this is an Ion, and it will give you its output configuration as well as software information and things about your Ion console. The About function works for almost anything in the console, and we'll cover some more uses of About later on. The other feature we want to make sure we cover before you get going is the Help feature, a very nice feature on the Ion console. It's like having the user manual built right into the desk, so if you ever get stuck, all you have to do is push Help, and it's a very important key to know where it is. It's over here in the frequently used function, right in the middle on the bottom row of this keypad over here. To use the Help feature, you simply push and hold Help, and then choose any other key on the console, including a soft key. So I'm going to go ahead and push the Go to Queue button because it's fairly close to help. And now in my CIA, I will see a description of the Go to Queue function and also some examples of how it's used. So whenever you get stuck, just remember that the help function has the manual built right in, and you can get reference there anytime you need it. And once you've gone through those steps, you're ready to begin programming. So let's get started. So when you're ready to start programming on your Ion console, the first thing you're going to have to do is know how to select the channels that you want to bring up. So in this section, we're going to talk about selecting channels. There are a few main ways to select channels on the Ion desk. Most of it is using the keypad. So let's look at the keypad and face panel functionality of selecting channels. For instance, maybe I wanted to select my channels 7 and 8. I could simply say 7 and 8. And I could even add something else by saying plus 11. And you notice here that I'm just typing numbers in onto my command line. And because I started from a blank command line, channel was assumed. All I had to do was start typing numbers, and the console said, ah, you're typing channels. And now I have the option here. Maybe I mistakenly typed 11 and I really wanted 12. I could hit clear and type a 2 instead of a 1. So now I'm looking at channel 7, 8, and 12, and you'll see on the console that I can now select those channels in any kind of order that I want to. So that's using the plus key. I could also use the through key to say 7, again, channel is assumed, through 12. And now I have grabbed all of the channels included in 7 through 12. Using the minus key, I can do something similar, but exclude a channel, say, in the middle. So 7 through 12 minus 9. Now I grabbed all of the channels that included in 7 through 12 except number 9. So the keypad and the plus, minus, and through key give me some pretty good flexibility in how I'm selecting the channels that I want to begin working with. There's another command on the console that makes selecting channels nice and easy, and that is a command called select last. Select last is located over here in the command keypad. It's the very middle key on the far right-hand row. It says select last. What that key will do is remember the last group of channels that I picked and simply repost them so that I can use it again, because if I'm doing programming, I may be selecting the same series of channels over and over and over, and select last is a good way for me to avoid typing all of the commands again. So again, it's all about speed and programming on this desk. So to use select last, I simply put select last, and the console will remember that the last time I chose some channels, I picked channels 7 through 12 minus number 9, and again, the console does that very quickly. So that was a nice fast way for me to repeat that command. Now, select last also has a couple of hidden features, and I can access those hidden features by pushing and holding select last and then looking at my first three soft keys. So let's take a look at those features right now. So I'm going to push and hold select last, and you'll see that soft key 1 through 3 give me a couple of additional options. Soft key 1 says select active. What select active will do when I push it is select any channel in my system that is active. Now, what do we mean by an active channel? An active channel is any channel that has an intensity above 0. It's very simple. Is it on? Yes or no? That's an active channel, if it's on. The other option I have is select manual. What select manual will do is select any channel that I have previously set or previously touched. Not a channel per se that would be in a queue or a submaster, but only channels that I have manually addressed so that I can quickly go back and find all of the channels that I have been working with, except any of the channels that might be up because of a queue. So that is select manual. And the third and final option under the select last soft key menu is select all. This one's pretty self-explanatory. Simply press select all, and all of my channels in the system are selected. So that is how you would use your keypad to select channels on your Ion console. And once you've selected channels, you can begin to work with them. In this section, I'm going to cover setting levels on your Ion console. One of the most intuitive ways to set a level on the Ion console is just by using the wheel. So for example, Maybe I wanted to take channel 1 and roll it up to 50%. I could simply type 1. Again, channel is assumed. And then I just have to roll the wheel. And I could roll it until it gets to 50%. I could do that as much as I want. Just pick a channel number and roll the wheel. It's very, very easy, very, very intuitive. Another way to set levels is by using the keypad and using a key called at. What this allows me to do is take a channel and specify a percentage that I want it to go to. For example, if I wanted channel 2 to go to 50%, I could simply type 2 at 50. And then if I change my mind and I say, no, I don't want it to go to 50, I want it to go to 55, I could simply hit clear because I haven't terminated my command line yet. Change the 50 to 55 and hit enter. And now channel 2 is at 55%. But I, of course, could still roll the wheel because that channel is selected. And maybe I did want it at 50% after all. I could just use the wheel to set very subtle looks with the wheel. Another key that we can use to quickly set a level to full is using the full key on the console. So maybe channel 3 wants to go to full intensity. I can simply say 3, full, enter. I don't need to use at here because full assumes the at. And again, I could adjust the level with the wheel, but I wanted it at full. Another very quick way to access a level for a channel is the opposite of full, and that's using the out key. Now the out key is great because it doesn't even require the use of an enter button, so it's a very fast way to turn a light off. So maybe I want to turn channel 1 off, I just hit 1, out, and I'm done. And now I can move on to another channel. So that's a very nice way to do it. Now there are a couple of shortcuts that you can do using some of the commands here on the Ion face panel. And one of them is a shortcut to get to the full function without pressing enter. So what I can do is if I want channel 4 to go to full, I could say 4 and just hit the at key 2 times very quickly, at. And that takes channel 4 to full. Another shortcut key is bringing a channel to what we call a default level. Now level is something that you can set in system settings, and we'll cover system settings a little bit later. But what this allows you to do is take a channel to a predetermined level that you always want to start from. In our case, I have it at 75%. To access the level feature on your Ion console, you're going to hit the full key twice. So, if I want to take channel 5 to my default level, I hit 5, full, and you'll see that that channel goes straight to 75%. Now, similar to the programmable level, the Ion also gives you the ability to program a plus and minus percentage. This is done in system settings, and right now I have it set for plus 10 and minus 10. Now this feature is accessed by hitting the at key and then a double hit of the plus key or the minus key. So here I have channel 5, it's at 75%. What I can do is I could say 5 at minus minus and it will drop it 10 points from wherever it was. At plus plus will do the opposite and bring it up 10 points from wherever it was. And again, that is programmable. I can have it be anything I want from 1 up to even 100% if I wanted to. Another shortcut that you can use on the Ion is a double hit of the select last key. Now what the select last key will do is take the last command in its entirety and post it for you to either redo it if you want to do something again, or you can make a subtle change to it. So I'll show you that now. I'm going to hit the select last key twice. And you'll see that the last command I did was a channel 5 at plus 10. Now I have the option of hitting enter to redo the plus 10, or I could hit clear and change that to simply say I want it to go to 70%. So the select last is a nice way to repost your last command and get back into it. So those are some of the methods that you will use to set levels on your Ion console. Once you've got your console set up, one of the first things you might want to do is run through a channel check to make sure that all of your lights are in good working order. So let's take a look at how to use the channel check feature on the Ion console. What I want to do first will be select the channels that I want to check, or starting with a channel, in this case maybe channel 1, and I can set it to a level. In this case, I'll put it at full. But before I actually complete that command, I want to go to More Soft Keys and hit my channel check function, which is on soft key 5. And now I press Enter. What the ion will do now is temporarily bring channel 1 to full, and I can use my next and last keys to step through forward or backward in my channel list. So if I'm in channel 1, I can hit next and step up through my channels one at a time, just to make sure that the lamp hasn't burned out and the light is focused in the proper location. It's really just going through my channels to make sure they're doing what I want. When I'm finished with my channel check, I press clear, and the console will exit channel check mode. One other feature you might want to be able to use to help identify where lights might be on your stage is a feature called Flash. What Flash allows me to do is pick a specific channel, and the console will do just that. It will flash the light so that it draws your attention and you can see where it happens to be pointed or how it's focused on the stage. So let's take a look at Flash. So if I'm in a queue, and I need to identify maybe where channel 3 is in this queue to see if it's turned on and pointed in the right direction, I simply hit channel 3. I hit my flash soft key, which again is under more soft keys, under soft key 2. Hit enter. And the console will temporarily remove this channel from wherever it was, if it was in a queue, and flash it on and off so that I can identify it in this particular look. Once I'm happy with where it's pointing, or I verify that it's doing what I want it to do, I can hit clear to take the console out of flash mode, and I am ready to continue with whatever I was doing. And that is how you will use channel check and flash on the ION. This section is going to cover using sneak on the ION console. More specifically, how to use sneak to remove a manual value that you've set using the keypad or the wheel. Using sneak in this fashion is the most similar to what you would use the release function on an ETC Express or Expression if you happen to be familiar with one of those disks. So let's take a look at how you would use sneak to remove a manual value on the ION. In my example here, I have manually set channels 1 through 6 to 75% to see what they look like. Well, now I want to see channel 1 returned to the value that it was in that queue. So what I want to do is maybe take channel 1 and undo the manual setting of 75% and return it to the background state that happens to be the queue. In order to do that, I would use the sneak command. So what I first want to do is select the channel that I want to sneak, in this case channel 1, and now I use the sneak button. Now the sneak button is prominently located right here in my command keypad in the upper right hand corner, so I will push sneak. And you can see that my command line says channel 1 sneak, and now I can just push enter. And now the channel is going to fade in a default time that is set up in system settings, which is changeable. And in the queue, it's at full, so now you can see that the manual value of 75 has been removed, and the channel has returned to its background state. If the channel had started in the off state, i.e. no queue playing, that channel would have faded to off. Another way you can use sneak is to sneak a channel to a manual value. For example, maybe I want to take channel 17 and it is off right now and I want to turn it on. So maybe I am in a situation where I need to add a light and I'm running my console in live. So what I can do is I can set channel 17 to a value just like I normally would, but before I complete the command, I use sneak. So maybe I want to bring channel 17 to 80%. Now before I push enter, which would just pop it onto 80% and the whole audience would notice that, I want to push sneak. And now if I push enter now, it will go to 80% in the default time that I have set in the console. But I could also at this moment specify a unique time for this particular command. And I do that by pushing the time key, which is in my record target keypad in the lower right hand corner. So I push time, and maybe I want this to happen in 7 seconds. So I now have channel 17 at 80, sneak time 7, and when I push enter, the console will very gracefully take channel 17 from 0 to 80%, and hopefully the audience won't notice or it will look intentional. So that's another use of sneak. You could also sneak a light out doing the exact same command, I could take it. If it was at 80, I could sneak it to 0 and do the exact same thing. And that is how you would use sneak to remove a manual value that you've set using the keypad or the wheel on an Ion console. Let's take a look at how to control non-intensity parameters on an Ion console. Your rig may contain some lights that can do a lot more than just turn on and off. Maybe you have a color scroller, or maybe you have some RGB type LED fixtures that you need to be able to control. The Ion gives you some very easy and flexible ways to control these types of devices, so let's take a look at how we're going to do that. Controlling non-intensity parameters is done on the Ion console using the non-intensity parameter control section, which is the top portion of the Ion face panel. And we're really referring to the four encoders and the associated display below them, as well as the category keys over here at the top right corner of the face panel. So let's look at a couple of examples. We'll start with a scroller to see how we can control that. And I do have a bank of scroller channels, 7 through 16 in this example. So what I want to do is grab channel 7 and first turn on its intensity. And I would do that like I would turn on any intensity channel, just by rolling the wheel, or I could enter a specific percentage on the keypad. Now I want to control the scroller, so how do I do that? Well, I can see on my channel display that scroller is part of the color category. So that indicates to me that I need to go up to my category keys and make sure that I'm in the color category. So I'm going to go ahead and push color. And there are several pages of color, and on the built-in LCD, you will see the category that you're working in and the page number and how many pages are in that category. And you can just repeatedly press the color key until the desired page appears that has the parameter you want to control. And in this case, I pushed the color key until scroller appeared, and it's on my encoder number 4. So now, encoder number 4 is going to control the scroller. I still have control of the intensity on the wheel. And when I turn my encoder for the scroller, you will see that the scroll begins to run through its colors. So that's how you would control a scroller. One of the nice things about the encoders on the Ion console is that they're also buttons. So I can push the encoder down and hold it to get some special functions that are available to me for that specific parameter. In this case, when I push and hold scroller, my soft keys now change to show me a few options that I have that are in addition to just turning the encoder. For instance, the first soft key says home, and that will return the scroller to its home position. Soft keys 2 and 3 are very nice because it's next and last, and what this will do is each time I push next, it will move the scroll to the next frame in the scroll because the console understands how far to move each time you press next or each time I push last. So that's a nice way, a nice quick way to move from color to color in your scroller. Let's look at another example, and this will be some color changing LED units. Our virtual rig has a row of RGB color changing units along for our psych. So let's look at controlling those. And those are my channels 51 through 62. Now again, because I'm working with RGB, this is a color parameter. So I want to make sure that I'm staying in my color parameter section, but I have to hit the color key until I find those parameters that I want to control. And I found them, they're here, RGB, and I can now roll those encoders to individually address the red, the green, and the blue LEDs. So I can do that now. Bring up intensity on those lights, and I can roll the blue and the green down to 0 so that I just have my red LEDs, or I can add some green, make amber, and now I can use RGB color mixing theory, add some blue, and take out the green, and there are the three colors that I'm able to do. Remember that these encoders are buttons, so when I push and hold the button, you will see that there are other special functions that are available to me for this parameter. Now these special functions will be different than the scroller function because, of course, this is a completely different type of device I'm controlling. So when I push and hold the button, for instance, for one of the colors, you'll see that I have the option to home the color, which will send it back to its home position. But I can also send it to a minimum value or a maximum value. And that is how you would use the non-intensity control section of your ion to control parameters beyond just intensity. In this section, we're going to cover recording on the ion console. And we've talked about bringing up levels, and we've looked at how to select channels and turn them on and create very nice looks on your stage. But now we need to figure out how to store those looks for recall later. And that is the record function on the console. So let's take a look at that. Now the two most common places you're going to record will be into cues and into subs. Now cues are designed to be played back in order. They just go in numeric order and you push your go button to go from one cue to the next cue. Your ion console can do up to 10,000 cues, so hopefully that should be enough. So let's look at how you would record these two things. First, we have to have a look on stage. So we're starting from a blank show, essentially, and I just want to create a nice opening look. And I'm going to bring channels 1 through 6 to full using my keypad, and we'll see in our virtual rig here that we have a nice gobo wash on the stage, and that's perfect because that's going to be our curtain warmer. So I want to make that my first cue in the system. So all I have to do to record that is press the record button, and that is prominently located here in my record target keypad in the upper right hand corner. Now when I push record, what I'm indicating to the console is that I really want to take a snapshot. It's like taking a picture or a digital image of my stage so that I can call it back later. So when I press record, the console is going to assume that I'm ready to record a cue. So at this point, all I have to do is push a number, and I want to record my first cue. And my first cue, I'm going to make number 1. Now, I actually have the ability to record cues with decimal points attached, so I could add a cue in front of Q1 if I need one later by recording a cue 0.5 or 0.55 if I need to, because I can go to 2 decimal points. But I want this to be Q1 because that's my first cue. So I've got my command line. When I typed the 1, the console assumed Q because, again, that's the most common. And all I have to do to complete that is press Enter, and the console will record the cue with all of the default levels for timing ready to go, and my cue shows up in my cue list, and I'm ready to use that cue. Recording a submaster is done in almost exactly the same way, but because the console assumes Q, I have to remember to hit the sub key before I execute the command, and the sub key is located in the record target keypad, second row up from the bottom, right in the middle. So maybe I want to use the same channels, but at a lower level. So I'm going to take my channels 1 through 6 and put them at 75%. And now I'm going to complete the command just like I did, but remembering to say record sub, and now specify the submaster that I want to record, in this case, sub number 1. And after I push enter, now that submaster is recorded. And if I have a submaster wing attached to my console, I can simply assign the submaster to be on one of my faders. And when I want to use that submaster, I just push the fader up and the submaster will go. And that is how you would use the record function on your ion console to record cues and subs. In this section, I'm going to go into greater detail about using groups on your ion console. Now, groups on an ion console may be a little bit different than what you're used to with groups on different consoles. There's a few key differences with groups on ion that you may not be used to. The first one is that groups on an ion console do not contain any level information for the channels. Groups are just about channel selection. The second main difference is that the ion remembers the order of the channels when you record the group. This will become important as you use groups later on in more advanced programming, where the order of the channels makes a difference. So let's look at how we can create groups on an ion console using those principles. For our example, we will create just a few very simple groups, and I'm going to concentrate on our first 6 channels in our rig. So in order to create a basic group containing channels 1 through 6, I first select the channels that I want to put into the group, for instance, 1 through 6. Now I don't put a level in because of course the console will not record the level, I'm just selecting channels. So once I have channel 1 through 6, now I can hit record and hit my group button. My group button is located in the record target keypad along the right hand side, right next to my number 1 button. So I hit group, and I want to record this as group number 1. And it's that simple. Now I want to create another group, and I want to illustrate how you can change the order of the channels. So I'm going to record the exact same group in the reverse order. So the syntax would look like this. 6 through 1, record group 2, enter. And now I've recorded the same 6 channels, but in the reverse order. Now in my last example, I want to use a more elaborate command to record a group because maybe I want to not use the through, but specify a very specific order of the channels that I want to record. Maybe I want to go outside in. So to do this, I first specify the channels in the order that I want. So I will do 1 and 6, and 2 and 5, and 3 and 4. So I'm working my way in. Now before I go ahead and record this group, which I'm going to be making this group 3, I want to continue this command. And one of the great things about the Ion console and its command line is that I can do multiple things at once. For instance, I can add a label to it right now. And I can do that by hitting the label key, which is located in my frequently used function button area. And I have two ways to label. One, I can use my mouse to click on my virtual keyboard that has popped up in my CIA. Or any little bit easier way is to use the external keyboard that came with the Ion console. And I'm going to label this group outside in. And I can actually press enter on my external keyboard to complete the command. So now I've recorded the group and labeled it at the same time. Now, if I want to see my groups so that I can make changes or label the additional groups, I need to go to the group list. And to get to the group list, all I have to do is hit the group button 2 times. And that will open up a list of the groups that I just recorded. And here you can see the group number, the label of the group, as well as the channels and the order that the channels were recorded in the group. Now to leave the group list, all I have to do is go back to my live display or hit escape in my display's keypad, and the console will return back out to the display that I was just in. And that is how you will record groups on an Ion console. Now that you've spent a lot of time recording cues on your Ion console, let's take a look at how you play them back. We're going to start by looking at our cue list, which again is the top half of my monitor here. And the cue list is going to display all of the cues that I've recorded on the console in numerical order. Now how I play back those cues is by hitting the large go button over here in my main playback fader. So I'm ready to go. I simply hit go. And the console will start with the first cue in the list, which happens to be cue number 1. Now I can continue to hit go and progress through my cue list. Each cue will happen in the default time of 5 seconds. In addition to pushing go, I can also use the stop back button. This is the stop back button because this button does both functions. If a cue is currently in process, in this case during my 5-second fade from one cue to the other, if I push the button during the fade, it will stop the cue. And I could then push go to continue the cue. If the cue has already completed, I can hit stop back and it will simply reverse through the cue list. So that's a nice way to be able to back up if I want to look at the cue before the one I was in. One other command you'll want to be familiar with in cue playback is the go to cue command. The go to cue command is very prominently located here in the center of my frequently used function keypad, directly above the plus key. The go to cue command sounds just like it is. It allows you to go to a specific cue in your cue list. For example, go to cue 5, enter, and the console will go to the finished state of cue 5. Now, the other function you would use the go to queue command would be to reset your queue list to the top so that you're ready to start the show. Now, there are two ways you can do this. You can do go to queue 0 or go to queue out. Now, these two are not the same. Let me explain the difference. Go to queue 0 will reset to the top of your queue list, but it will only take intensities down to 0. If you have scrollers or other non-intensity parameters in your rig, it will leave them where they were. So you're only affecting intensity when you go to queue 0. If you go to queue out, you will also reset your queue list to the top of the list, but you will also take all of your non-intensity parameters to their home state. This is something to keep in mind, especially if you have a lot of scrollers, because if you are going to queue out, you are going to send all of your scrolls back to their home position, whereas go to queue 0 would leave the scroll where it was and simply fade the intensity out. So just keep in mind that subtle difference with the go to queue 0 and go to queue out. Another feature we want to talk about is using the load command. Now, what the load command allows you to do is prep a queue and have it ready to go so that I can take it on queue. And I would use this if I wanted to skip a couple of queues or go to a specific queue out of order, but I want to take it on queue using the go button as opposed to using the go to queue command, which is a little bit more abrupt. The way I use the load command is I select the queue that I'm going to want to go to. In this case, I'm in queue 0. I'll go ahead and step into queue 1. And I want to draw your attention now to the center of this display where we have our master playback status. What is showing here is queue number 1 is the current queue. It's the one that's in bright yellow. You can see that it's gone to 100% of its completion. Just to the right of the yellow oval telling you that that's queue 1, you see a dark oval with number 2. What that's telling you is that queue 2 is the next queue in line to happen. Well, maybe I don't want queue 2 to happen because something has happened in my show, we have to cut it short a little bit, and I want to go right to Q4, but I want Q4 to be hit with the go button in time. So what I want to do is select the queue, I type Q4, enter, and now I hit the load key. And the load key is appropriately located at the very top of my playback fader, and it's labeled load. So now I hit load, and you'll see that the pending queue, instead of Q2, is now Q4. Now, in perfect time, right as the stage manager says go, I hit go, and Q4 happens instead of Q2. So the load is a nice way to prep a queue for playback and use the go button to make it happen. And now I can continue playing down my queue list into queue number 6, and when I reach the last queue in my list, my little show only has 6 queues, hopefully yours has more. I can use the go to queue 0 or go to queue out command to reset to the top of the list, and I am ready to do the show again. And that's how you will play back your cues on an Ion console. In this section, I'm going to cover the concept of background faders on the Ion console. What background faders on the Ion console allow you to do is play multiple cues simultaneously, even though there's only one playback fader pair and one go button physically on the console. This is a similar concept to a dual playback fader pair on other consoles, but with the Ion, you have like a dual playback fader pair times 1,000, so it's really, really cool. Let's take a look at how this is going to work. In our example, I have a queue number 1, which is a very long queue, it's 30 seconds. And queue number 1, in this example, maybe is a nice sunrise queue that starts off the top of my play. But shortly thereafter, when I start the sunrise queue, I have my actors that make an entrance, and they need their light on because they begin speaking immediately, so I'll have to take queue number 2 before queue number 1 is finished. Not to worry, because the Ion console says, I'm going to finish queue number 1 even though you've gone into queue number 2, because queue number 2 doesn't touch the channels that queue number 1 is addressing. So in a way, it just takes that queue number 1, puts it into the background, and lets it keep going. So let's see how that looks when I play it. So I'm at the top of show, and I'm waiting for the stage manager to call Q1, and then rightly thereafter, she's going to call queue number 2. So I get the call, go on Q1, and go on Q2 to bring up the actor's key lights. Now what you can see is that Q2 will complete and Q1 is still running. I can see queue number 1 as a little status indicator here in the playback status indicator, and queue number 3 is pending. In fact, I can go ahead and take queue number 3, and queue number 3 will now change the lights again because the maybe more actors entered, but queue number 1 continues to run because queues 2 and Q3 don't actually touch the channels that are involved in the sunrise. So what background faders allow you to do on the Ion console is run a lot of complicated cues on one playback fader pair. As you run through the cues that you've recorded on your Ion console, you will inevitably notice that the default fade time, in our case 5 seconds, probably isn't going to work for every single cue, because of course things happening on stage are pretty dynamic and one time fits all is not necessarily going to hold up in this case. But not to worry, because the Ion gives you a lot of flexibility in how your cue timing can be programmed. So let's take a look at how we might modify our cue timing on the Ion console. I first want to pull your attention to our cue list display so we can see the timing information here. And the column directly to the right of my cue list and the cue numbers will tell me what time that cue is going to occur in. In our case here, the default is 5 seconds. What that means is that every time I go to a new cue, the lights are going to fade from one cue to the next in 5 seconds. Maybe Q1, which is my first cue in the show, needs to be longer than 5 seconds because it's the opening cue and I want it to be a little bit longer. What I can do is first specify the cue that I want to address by typing Q1, and now I hit the time key. And the time key is in a very prominent location in the bottom right-hand corner of my record target keypad. So I hit time. And now I can specify a time in seconds on how long I want that cue to be. Maybe I want it to be 3 seconds longer, so I'll make it 8 seconds. And 8 seconds will show on the command line. Now the Ion actually gives you a lot of flexibility. You can enter hours, minutes, and seconds on this, and you can also add a decimal point to go down to 1/100 of a second if you want to. But for our purposes, we'll just pick a nice round 8 seconds. I'm going to push enter, and you'll see in the timing column that Q1 is now going to occur in 8 seconds. Another option that the Ion console gives you is the ability to do what's called a split time. A split time is just that. It basically says that the lights that are fading up in the queue can fade at a different speed than the lights that are going out in the queue. This is useful if you want to pull focus to a portion of the stage faster than you want to release the focus from another part of the stage. So let's take a look at how we would do a split time on the Ion. First, I need to select which queue I want to split, and I'm going to split my queue number 2. So I'm going to type Q2. And then I start this off just like I normally would. I'm going to hit time. And the first thing I want to do is enter my upfade time. And maybe what I want to do is pull focus to a portion of the stage rather rapidly because somebody starts talking or starts singing very quickly, and I want to get the audience looking at that actor right away. So 2 seconds up. And now before I complete this command, I need to hit the time key again. And the console is now asking me to do a downtime. So maybe what I want to do is fade out the lights that were on, not too drastically, maybe in 6 seconds, so that we pull focus to our new actor in 2, and the other ones kind of just fade off into the background in 6. To complete the command, I push enter, and the console will now display in our cue list 2 separate times. We have a column for intensity up, and a separate column for intensity down, so you can very quickly see what the timing of that cue is going to be. You'll also notice that if the up and down timing is the same, that the timing is shown in the very center, kind of splitting the intensity up and intensity down, so you can see that the timing of up and down is the same. So at a quick glance of your cue list, you can see what's happening with the timing. Let's take a look at how that sequence is going to run on the Ion console using our virtual rig. I'm in Q0, so I am simply going to push go to start into Q1, and we'll see that our initial cue is going to have a nice, clean 8-second fade up. And it's complete. And now I want to go ahead and run that cue where I want to pull focus to a portion of the stage while gently fading out the rest. So I'm going to hit go, and you'll see that we have lights coming up very rapidly while the other lights that are fading out in a slower time. So that is a split time. There is one other option you can do with the timing here, and that is a manual time. And what a manual time allows you to do is just that, manually control the time. Because sometimes a computer counting in a defined set of seconds may not match what's happening on stage, because what's happening on stage may change from show to show. And a manual time allows the operator to follow the action and match the cue timing with the action that's occurring on the stage. This is accomplished by moving the fader pair from the bottom to the top in the time that you need the fade to occur from start to finish. So let's look at how you would do that on your Ion console. Now for our purposes, I'll make Q3 a manual time. So I begin the same way I would changing the time on any cue. I type Q3, time, and now instead of specifying a time in seconds, my soft key number 3, gives me the option to add a manual time. So my command line says Q3 time manual. I push enter, and the cue list display will now show me that Q3 has a manual time. Now before I take a manual cue by pushing go, I need to make sure that my fader pair is all the way down at the bottom. And this is a fader pair because one of the faders is going to control my intensity up channels, and one fader pair is going to control my intensity down channels. So in theory, I could do a manual split time by moving the two faders in separate times. But what I'm going to do is just push the two faders up simultaneously so I get a nice clean fade from Q2 to Q3, as if it was just a normal non-split cue. So now when I push go, the console does nothing except tell me that Q3 is waiting for me to do something. Now when I'm ready for the cue, I'm watching the action on stage, and as the action occurs, I can follow it by pushing the faders up slowly, and then the action maybe speeds up so I can push the faders up a lot faster to go ahead and complete that cue. So the nice thing about a manual time is the manual time can vary with the action on the stage. So those are some examples of how you would use automatic, split, and manual timing on your Ion console. One of the challenges of using multi-parameter type fixtures in your rig is you run the risk of seeing them move when you really don't want them to. For example, maybe I have a rig of scrollers, and I'm not using the scrollers until a certain point in my show, but then I do get to a cue where I've moved them to a color and I turn the intensity on. When I push go on that cue, because I am running the color and the intensity at the same time, as the light's fading up, I'm going to see that scroll getting into position. One of the things that Ion has is a feature called AutoMark. And what AutoMark will do is recognize when you have a non-intensity parameter that needs to be preset or marked in a cue just before the one that you actually turn the light on. It's a very nice, convenient way that you don't have to think about making sure that you have the light already set up so that when you turn it on, you don't see the colors moving around. So we're going to show you an example of how that works. I have a cue up right now, my cue number 4, that has the lights with my scrollers turned off, and my scrollers are in their home position. Now when I go to Q5, which has those lights turned on and the scrolls in a new position, you'll see that as the light fades up, the scroll is moving from one color to the next, until finally over the 5 seconds, it gets to the place where it's supposed to be. Not exactly a very attractive way to get into that color. You have an option. You could create a cue before Q5 that moves the scroll, and then Q5 actually turns that light on, but that's kind of a hassle, and you're making unnecessary cues. If you turn AutoMark on your console, the console handles it for you and finds a place, moves your scrolls before you turn those lights on. It's a very nice feature. Now we'll cover how to turn AutoMark on in the setup portion of the training, but I'm just going to go ahead and turn it on so that you can see the difference between the cue I just ran and running the same cues with AutoMark enabled. I've enabled AutoMark on the console. And you'll know this is turned on because in your queue list, you'll see that the queue just before queue number 5 has an M in the column for Mark. What that's telling me is that the console has recognized that, you know, I've got some scrollers or maybe some color mixing LEDs that are in a position in queue 5, but they're not in the same position in queue 4. And if the intensity is to turn on in queue 5, you're going to see that move happening live, just like we did in the first example. With AutoMark turned on, however, once I go into Q4, those scrollers are already in their position, so when I take Q5, the light just fades up in the color it's supposed to be in. So that's how you can use a feature called AutoMark to preset your non-intensity parameters on an Ion console. Submasters on an Ion console are one of the most intuitive and easy ways to play back looks that you have stored in your desk. What I have here is a fader wing that I have configured to be submasters. Now, your Ion console may look a little bit different depending on the configuration. You may have more or less faders than we do, but the way you operate the subs and configure them is exactly the same. Now, in the setup portion of the training, we talk about how to configure the faders to be submasters. But I already have my wing set up to be subs, so we can start using them right away. So let's take a look at some of the concepts involved in using submasters for playback. I have a couple of subs recorded, and the general idea behind a sub is that whatever I have recorded into the handle, or the submaster, will fade proportionally depending on where I have the fader in its line of travel. So on my submaster 18 over here, I have channels 1 through 3 recorded at full intensity, so that as I move the fader up and down in its line of travel, the levels will correspond to with where the fader is. So if I've got the fader roughly halfway through its travel, the lights that are recorded there will be at half the intensity that they're recorded in. Now, of course, it is proportional, so if I had those levels stored at 50%, halfway up would actually put them at 25%. I have another submaster that is 3 different channels, channels 4, 5, and 6, and now I want to create a submaster that is the combination of the two. So I'm going to bring up those submasters, and I'm going to use a sub-recording shortcut to take all of those channels and put them into a brand new submaster. I happen to have a submaster 20 that is open. What I want to do is hit record, and now I can simply hit the bump button up submaster 20, and now I have recorded that look that's up on my stage into submaster 20. So I can pull down 18 to 19, push up 20, and you can see that it looks exactly the same. We like to say that submasters are highest takes precedence. What that means is that if a submaster or a couple of submasters contain the same channels, whichever submaster has those common channels at a higher level, that submaster is going to win. So let's look at an example of that. So here I have channels 1, 2, and 3 in a submaster, and I'm going to put them just over half. And now if we remember, I have a submaster that also contains channels 1, 2, and 3, and I'm going to start to fade that submaster up just by pushing up the fader. And you'll notice the channels 1, 2, and 3 aren't doing anything. But as my second submaster approaches the 52% level and takes over 52%, you'll notice that now channels 1, 2, and 3 are going to the new level because it's higher in my second submaster. So again, that's highest takes precedence. Whoever has a higher level wins. Now, as I pull my second submaster down, once my channels 1 through 3 reach their 52%, they will stop right there because submaster 18 is telling them to stay there, and the rest of the sub will go all the way out to their lowest level, or all the way out. Now, depending on the configuration of your Ion console, you may have a varying number of submasters. Now, on my 2x20 fader wing here, I have the option of changing pages on that wing so that I can have submasters 1 through 20 on my first page, 21 through 40 on my second page, and in banks of 20. Let's take a look at how to change pages, and this is the same regardless of how your console is set up. We do this using a button called Fader Control. Now, Fader Control is located up here in between my soft key 1 and a button called load. And what I want to do is push fader control and hold it. And now you'll see that the display that's on the Submaster Wing will show me the pages that are available to me. There are 15 pages available, and the page that is currently loaded will be represented by a blinking light on the bump button that corresponds to that page. In order for me to change that page, I simply have to decide what page I want to go to and press the appropriate bump button to get to that page. So in this case, I want to go to page 2, so I will find the button that is corresponding to page 2. I will push that, and now I can release the fader control button, and now I have changed the page, and I'm now looking at Submasters 21 through 40. The nice thing about Submaster pages on an Ion console is that I can continue to change pages, and the Ion remembers the level where that sub was left when you leave the page. Now, the fader won't actually move, but you can continue to use that fader for the new sub without affecting the level of the sub that you left up. To make a change to that sub's level, you simply go back to that page, move the fader to where it was, and the console lets you take over right where you left off. Now I'll go ahead and change back to page 1, and we're ready to go. So you have all of your cues created, and you're going through rehearsal, and of course you're going to have to change something. So let's take a look at how you would edit your cues on an Ion console. Specifically, in this chapter, we'll talk about using Update to edit your cues live. So let's take a look. We have a cue up, and we need to make some changes. So the Ion console has a very, very convenient feature called Update that allows you to do this. Now, technically, I could make some changes and re-record the cue, but again, record is typically reserved for creating new cues. Update actually expands the functionality. The console understands that you have an existing cue and you just want to make some changes to it, so there are some added features that Update allows you to do that record does not. So let's take a look at those. So I'm going to make some changes to my cue that we have up currently. Just some intensity channels. My first 6 intensity channels, I'm going to modify them a little bit because in this particular cue, they were too bright. So I'm going to bring them down. Well, that is perfect. That's right where I want them. Now all I have to do to update is find my update key, and the update key is conveniently located in my record target keypad, 2 down from the record key and across the aisle from number 4. So I just push update. One of the nice things about update is that the Ion in the CIA, remember the CIA is the lower portion of my right-hand monitor, will give us a summary of what's about to be updated. This is something you don't get with record, so this is a very nice feature of update. What you see in the update summary window, all the way to the left you have a column that shows you the cue number first and foremost, the cue that you're going to be updating, and then it will tell you what is going to be updated by category and by channel number in a table. So we can see very quickly here that in Q5, I'm updating intensities, which is what the INT, FOC is focus, COL is color, and the whole word beam is there. So I'm updating intensities for channels 1 through 6, and that is indicated by the little plus symbol telling me that I'm making a change. What's nice about this is I can quickly see, is that what I want to update? If it is, fantastic, I complete the command by pushing enter, and the console will update that particular cue. Let's take a look at another example of using update, because update also gives us the ability to selectively update only specific channels. So what I want to do is take my same 6 channels and make another change. Okay, and now let's take a look at those channels in more detail. I have made a manual change to those channels. So they are indicated in a red color. Their intensities are in red. Now red on the Ion is a little bit different than what you may be used to if you have been operating an ETC Express or an ETC Expression, where red meant captured. Red on an Ion simply means manual. Now what a manual value means is I have changed their intensity using the keypad. Those channels are not locked at those values. If I push go right now, or if I reload the current cue that I'm in using the go to command, those channels will fade right back to where they were. I could also use the sneak command to put them back to where they were, and I'll show you how to do that in just a moment. But let's first go back to update because I have some manual values, and that's really the key here with update, is that update looks at manual values that you've set in the console. But rather than updating all six of my intensities, I just want to update three of them because the designer has said, well, I want to save channels 1, 2, and 3 in this queue where they are, but 4, 5, and 6, they can go back where they were. Okay, well, how do we do that? First, I want to update the channels that need to be updated in the queue. 1 through 3, update. I'll look at our update status window. It's going to tell me that in Q5, I'm updating intensities for channel 1, 2, and 3. Notice this is a little bit different. Even though 4, 5, and 6 are still at manual values, they're not being updated in the queue because I have excluded them from my selection. So now when I push enter, channels 1, 2, and 3 are no longer red because they have been updated in the queue and they go to the appropriate queue color, but 4, 5, and 6 stay manual because I've done nothing with them. Now I have a couple of options. I could go to the next queue and 4, 5, and 6 will go to their appropriate values. Or alternatively, I could just hit sneak enter, which I'll do that now, and 4, 5, and 6 will sneak back to their original level in the queue. Now I can push go, and the queues will continue to run normally. And that's how you would use update to edit a queue live on your Ion console. In this section, we're going to cover making changes to your queues in blind on the Ion console. Now, making a change in blind sounds pretty self-explanatory. You can make a change live, of course, which means it's happening on stage. But if you are in the middle of a run or a tech and you've got action going on stage and you know you have to make a change to a queue, the Ion lets you go into what's called blind mode, pick any queue in your system, and make changes there without affecting anything on the stage itself. So let's take a look at how we would use blind on the Ion. To get to the blind display, you look at your display's keys, and it's in the top row of keys right in the middle, and it says blind. When you push the blind display, you'll notice that it has a blue LED to tell you that you are in blind mode. Now, one of the things you'll notice about blind mode is that it is arranged very, very similar to the way the live display is. In fact, it's formatted the same way. The same formats apply and the same flexi modes apply in blind as they would in live. But there are a few key differences in the way this display is presented to you in its color scheme, just to give you a visual indicator that you're in blind. It's nice to know at a glance, am I working in live or am I working in blind? Because of course, as you can imagine, if you think you're in blind and you're actually in live, you may have a director screaming at you. So, let's take a look at the blind display and how it differs slightly from the live display. First of all, the background is a grayish blue color instead of black, and our command line is outlined with a blue line instead of an amber line. And that is going to be the general color scheme on the Ion. If you're looking at an amber command line, just realize you're making things happen live. If you're looking at a blue command line, you can realize that you're making changes in blind. So those are some key differences. Now, in addition to the colors of the display itself, we want to take a look at the colors of the values of the channels themselves, because you go into a blind display and these colors actually mean something to you. Working through the display, you'll see primarily three different colors. You'll see blue, you'll see green, and then you'll see a purplish magenta color. Blue are channels that have gone up in value from the previous queue. So I'm looking at my queue number 5 and I can see that channels 1 through 6 are blue. That means that in the queue before, those channels were at a lower value. So they come up in value in Q5, they are blue. Now if we look at, for this example, our channels 23 and 24, they're green. And that indicates to me that these values have gone down from Q4, so they were at a higher level in Q4. Now there's a really good memory cue for this because blue is the sky, those are channels going up, and green is the grass, and those are channels going down. The purple channels, that just means that the level hasn't changed from the previous queue. So that's very easy to see. I can see that channels 25 and 26, they're at 75% in this queue. Well, they're at the exact same level in Q4. To move around my queues in the blind display, I can simply type the queue number. If I wanted to look at Q4, I could type Q4, enter, and now I'm looking at Q4. Or I could also use next and last. And next and last are here in the frequently used command area above my command keypad, so I can simply page through next and last. Now, once we're in blind, you can select channels and make changes to their levels the same way you would in live. One thing to remember about blind, however, on the Ion console is that when you make a change here, the change is immediate and permanent. Save the undo key. You can, of course, undo something you've done. But the thing to remember is that you're not presented with a not recorded thing flashing like you were if you're used to using an Express or Expression console from ETC. And Ion automatically saves. So I'm simply going to make a change to my channel 1 by grabbing channel 1 on my command line and rolling the wheel. You'll notice that the value is not going manual because, of course, a manual value would indicate that I would then be doing something with it. But here it stays in the queue in its appropriate color. In this case, it's still blue because I've moved it to a level that is still higher than the previous queue. But I don't need to do anything at this point. I've made my change to the channel, and that change is now permanent. So if I go back out to live, notice the black background and the amber command line. Now when I go to Q5, you'll see that my new channel 1 is going to its new intensity that I set in blind. And that is how you would use blind to edit cues on your Ion. In this section, I'm going to cover using tracking versus cue-only mode on the Ion. Now, because the Ion is considered a move fade desk, that is, when you record a cue, all you're recording are the moves from one cue to the next, the Ion lets you work in both modes. Now, we find that tracking is best for creating your show, and cue-only is a very efficient way to edit your show. So let's take a look at these two modes. To best illustrate this, I'm going to go to blind and look at spreadsheet. And now what we can see here, very easily, we can see our magenta or our purpley color channels that have tracked in from the cues before it. Now the easiest way to illustrate this is for me to change the original move instruction. Let's take a look, for example, at cue number 3 and channel number 6 together. All right, you can see that in Q2, that channel was at 0, and then it moved into a full intensity in channel 3. So that is the original move instruction. Now you'll notice in Qs 4 and 5 that the level is still at full, and then finally in Q6 it goes to 56%. Well, the reason it's still at full in Q4 and 5 is because I haven't told it to do anything else. So if I change it in Q3, the console is also going to make the change in Q4 and Q5 because Q4 and Q5 have no move instructions associated with channel 6. So anytime I change the original move instruction, it'll automatically change all of the levels downstream until it gets a new move instruction, in this case, to go to level 56. Let's take a look at this exact example, but with the console in queue only mode. Now to go into queue only mode, I need to go into setup. So I'll hit Displays, Setup, and in Desk Settings, and in the Record Defaults submenu, I can find a field that allows me to change the tracking mode from Track to Cue Only Mode. Now when I go back to Blind, and I do that same example, and I make a change to this move instruction, it doesn't track through. I only affect the move instruction for that cue. Channel 4 gets its own new move instruction to go to full. I'm going to go ahead and put the console back into tracking mode by going into Setup, Desk Settings, and change Track back to tracking mode because I want to talk to you about a feature on the Ion called Block. Now what Block allows me to do is insert a block where I can stop tracking from occurring. And this can be done on a channel-by-channel basis or even a queue-by-queue basis. So let's take a look at that. Looking at the same example, I would like to have channel 6 not track into queues 4 and 5. Now I can do this by inserting what's called a partial block, and I can block that channel on an individual basis. Now to do this, all I have to do is re-enter the same move instruction in my next queue. So in Q4, channel 6, I simply have to put it at full again, and the console will now indicate that I have a full level, but because it is not tracked, the color has changed and it's now in white to indicate that that's a blocked channel. Now if I go into Q3 and modify, you'll see that that value does not track through because I have inserted a block. Now if I want to remove the block and allow the track to come back through, so there if I set channel 3 at 80%, now you'll notice that because I put a manual full value in Q4, that's a new move instruction. However, if I want to remove that move instruction, I can go to Q4 and I can hit 6 at enter. And what 6 at enter will do is remove the manual move instruction, and it will allow that tracked value to propagate through to the following queues until, of course, I get a new move instruction to take it to 56%. So that is how you would block on a channel by channel basis. I could also block an entire queue. This is quite easy. I just type Q4, for instance, and I can hit my block key, and the block key is in my frequently used command section directly above my through key. And now you can see that I took all of my channels in Q4 where they had tracked, and I inserted a block there. So now Q4 becomes a block queue. So that if I pick any of my channels in Q3 and make a change, it won't make it past Q4. And I can simply repeat the command to undo the block to allow the tracked values to propagate. And that's how you would use tracking or queue-only mode on your Ion console. In this section, I'm going to cover making edits to submasters on your Ion console. One way you can do this is making edits in live. So you simply bring up your submaster, make your changes, and then store your changes. Now what's great about this is that the update feature on the Ion desk makes editing submasters very, very easy. And it adds a couple of additional functions in case you're doing some pretty complicated edits. So let's take a look at using update to edit your submaster live. First thing I want to do is bring up my sub. And we can see our yellow values, which indicate that they are from a submaster. And all I have to do to use update is make my change to my channel. I hit the update command and the bump button of the appropriate sub. Now the great thing about update is that it maintains the integrity of the submaster so that only channels that were in the sub can be updated. So if I had a channel 5 change and a channel 4 change, channel 4 wasn't in the sub originally. So when I use the same update command, update bump, only channel 5 gets updated because that channel was originally in the sub. Now, if I wanted to add channel 4 to the submaster, that's no problem. I can specify the channel ahead of time, 4, update, bump, and you can use update to add a channel to a submaster. Now, if you want to delete a channel from a submaster, that can be done in blind, and that's covered in a different section. But you can use update to make changes to original channels and add channels to a submaster. Now, because update maintains that integrity, you can use update even when you have a combination of sources creating your look on stage. So for instance, I have a queue up. So I'll make a change to channel 20, which is in the submaster, and I'll make a change to channel 3, which is in the queue. What's great about this is I can say update bump for the sub, and it maintains the integrity of the sub, and then I can complete the command just by saying update enter, and it will complete the command for the queue. So the console with update remembers the integrity of each of the original sources. So that's a very, very nice feature of update. And that's how you would use update to modify a submaster live on the Ion. Let's take a look at how you would edit a submaster in blind on the Ion. To do this, we need to go into our blind display. And the blind display key is located in my display's keypad at the top, right in the middle. And you'll notice that the blind display defaults to Q. If I want to look at a sub, I just have to type the submaster that I'm interested in editing and press enter. I want to edit sub 10. Enter. And now we can see that the channel and level information is being displayed for submaster 10. Now if I want to make a change to a channel, I simply select the channel and make the change. So if I want to change channel 1 from full down 10 points or so, I just simply grab the channel and set its level with the wheel or the keypad, however I would normally set levels. And the thing to remember about Blind is that changes are immediate. You do not have to re-record when you make a change in Blind, so keep that in mind. One other thing you can do in Blind is add a channel to this submaster. So maybe channel 4, you can see that channel 4 is not part of this sub right now. If I want to add channel 4, I simply grab the channel, assign a level to it, and the mere act of assigning a level to channel 4 adds it to the submaster. Again, I don't have to re-record. I've just gone ahead and made that modification. If I want to remove a channel from a submaster, this can be thought of in two different ways. I may want the channel to technically stay part of the sub for update features in live, because remember, update maintains the integrity of the channel list. And I technically may want channel 4 to be considered part of the submaster, but when I bring that handle up, I may not want channel 4 to actually have a value associated with it. So I can set channel 4 to a zero intensity in the submaster. So channel 4 is technically part of this sub, but if I bring up this submaster, channel 4 won't have a level associated with it. If you want to remove a channel from a submaster, I can use the at enter command. Essentially what I'm doing is I'm hitting at, leaving the intensity blank, and pushing enter. What that signals to the console is remove the channel from the sub. So channel 4, at, leave intensity blank, push enter, and that channel is now removed from the submaster. That is how you will edit your submasters in Blind on the Ion. In this section, I'm going to cover editing your groups on the Ion console. So let's take a look at how we do that. The primary way that you're going to edit your groups is by going to the group list so that you can first see your group numbers and the channels that are already in the groups, and you can modify those channels right from the group list. So let's do that. Now remember, to get to your group list, it's a double hit of the group key, and that will open up our group list. Now we have a couple of groups here, and we can very quickly see the group number, the label of the group if it has one, and the channels and their order. Remember that groups on an Ion console are just channels, and the groups remember what order you typed in those channels. Let's make a very simple edit first. Let's look at group number 4. So I'm going to type group 4, enter. Group 4 will be highlighted. Now I can change this channel range. Maybe I only want this channel range to be 17 through 26. I simply type 17 through 26. I verify with my command line that it says chan, or channel, 17 through 26. I push enter. The console asks me to confirm my selection because I'm making an edit to the group. And I push enter. And now group number 4 is 17 through 26. So that is an edit of a range group. Now if I look at group number 3, you'll see that I have a group labeled outside in, and this is where I chose a very specific order of channels. Now what if I wanted to add channel 7 in between where I have channels 6 and 2? That is no problem because I have soft keys that give me the ability to insert before or insert after to put channel 7, insert after the channel 6, and you'll see that channel 7 has now been put in between 6 and 2. If I want to remove a channel from my list, I can use my delete command. Maybe I want to get rid of channel 6 in this group. I can simply say channel 6, delete, enter. The console will ask me to confirm that change because I'm deleting a channel from a group. Push enter, and channel 6 has been deleted. Now I could make very simple edits to my groups live if I wanted to. I could go to live, select my new channel range, and re-record the group. But what's nice about the group list is I can see how the group currently stands, and I can quickly see after I make the edit that the group is now exactly the way I want it. So that is how you will edit your groups using the group list on the Ion console. This section is going to cover how to copy, move, or delete record targets that you may have created on your Ion console. Now, these features are best done in the respective list of the target you want to change. So if you want to be copying or moving or deleting cues, it's probably best to do that from the cue list. Likewise, if you want to copy, move, or delete subs, you want to do that from the sub list or the group list or anything else that you might want to change. So let's take a look at how you would copy, move, or delete objects using the correct record target list. Now remember, to get to a record target list, it's a double hit of the record target on the record target keypad. For our example, we're going to look at working with cues and our cue list. So I'm going to go ahead and double hit cue. And this cue list that comes up on the channel display is different, not in content, but in the fact that the static cue list over here isn't really a cue list that you can interact with, whereas the cue list that comes up when you double hit the cue button is a list that you can actually interact with a command line. So let's first take a look at how you would copy a cue. So I want to copy cue 1 to a new position in between cue 2 and 3. So what I would do is first specify the cue that needs to be copied, Q1, hit my copy to button, which is up here in the center of my frequently used command section, copy to. Now I specify the new location, Q2.5, and push enter. And after confirmation, new Q2.5, which is a copy of Q1. Now that I've copied Q1, maybe I want to move the original Q1 to the end of the cue list. So I can do that using the move to command. So again, I select the cue that's going to be moved. I hit the copy to button twice to get moved to. Now I specify the next available number. Next available whole number happens to be 7, so I'll move that to Q7. And confirm that. And now the original Q1 has been moved to 7, so there is no longer a Q1, but all of its contents have been moved to a new queue labeled 7. Now if it turns out I don't need that queue at all, I can delete that cue using the delete button, and delete button is over here in the lower left-hand portion of this frequently used command keypad. And I simply intuitively type the command, delete Q7, enter. The console will ask for confirmation. I push enter, and Q7 is gone. So remember that to copy, move, or delete is most efficiently done in the record target list of the associated record target, so that you have maximal use of all the commands available to you. And that is the method you will use to copy, move, or delete record targets on the Ion. In this chapter, I'm going to show you how to use very simple step-based effects on the Ion console. A step-based effect is one type of effect that can be created on the Ion, and this is the type of effect that is the most similar to boards that you may have used in the past. So let's take a look at creating a step-based effect on the Ion. The step-based effect is created in the effects display. Now to get to this display, I need to double hit the effect key, which is located just above the record key. So a double hit of that. And we are brought to our effect list, and our CIA now becomes our main editing window for the effect package. Now you'll notice in the list that there are several effects that are already in the console, and these effects are primarily used for multi-parameter type fixtures. Now our step-based effect is typically used for intensity channels, and we're going to be creating it from scratch. So let's take a look at how we do that. The first thing I need to do when creating a new effect is decide what effect number I want that to be. In this case, I want to just create a new effect number 1, so I just hit effect 1, enter. The CIA will give me a list of buttons asking me to decide what type of effect I want. And step-based is the first one, so I'll use my mouse and click on step-based. And now the CIA is going to give me a display that will look pretty similar to the effect display that you would have found maybe on a previous console, where I have columns and rows. Now the concept of a step-based effect is pretty simple. Basically, I specify a number of steps and the console plays each step individually. When it reaches the last step, it loops back to the beginning and continues to run that until I tell it to stop. Each step usually contains a channel or multiple channels, and whenever the step is active, those channels are usually on. So what I need to do, the two things I really need to do in creating a step-based effect is first, specify my steps, and second, put channels in those steps. So let's look at that. To specify my steps, I'm going to use a series of commands that are at the bottom of my effect editor. And the first one says step, and I'm going to use my mouse and click on step. Now I have to decide how many steps I would like in this effect. I'm going to do a 6-step effect. 1 through 6 is how I could do all 6 at the same time. Enter. And now you can see that I have all 6 steps created and selected. Now what I can do is use my arrow keys. And my arrow keys, again, are my displays keypad. If I right arrow over 1, I can move into the channels column of the steps. And I can use the through command to assign channels to all of the steps all at once. And in this case, I want to use my first 6 channels as well. So 1 through 6, and enter. And you'll see that the ion will automatically distribute those channels evenly. And because I have the same number of steps and the same number of channels, it winds up being 1 channel per step. Now I could go into each step individually and assign 1, 2, or as many channels as I want, but in this case I want to see 1 at a time. So once I have those two things completed, I have steps and I have channels, I'm ready to see this effect running. So in order to see this effect running, I go out to live, my live display. I pick the channels that I want to see activated in this effect, which are channels 1 through 6, and I simply give them the instruction to go to effect number 1 by typing effect 1, enter. Now effect 1 is playing as a manual value. The effect lives on its own. It's not an entity in the console that is stored as a cue or a sub yet. This is basically just the effect running on its own as a manual value, and you can see in our virtual display that we have our channels stepping from 1 to 2 to 3 up through 6 and then back to 1. Now you'll notice in the channel display that my level has indicated that it's playing E1 or effect 1. I can push and hold the data key to see the underlying information, and you can actually see the percentages fading from 0 up to full and then back down to 0 as the step becomes active and then inactive again. Now if I want to clear this manual value from the channels, I can simply sneak enter, and that removes the manual value. I haven't done anything to the effect, it still is there, and if I want to go back to it, I can double click the effect key again, and it will take me back to that effect, and I can make changes here if I need to. And that is how you would create and play back a very simple step-based effect on the Ion console. This chapter is going to cover making some basic modification to step-based effect timing on the Ion console. So let's take a look at that. I'm going to go to a previously created step-based effect by double-hitting my effect key. Now, if you remember, what a step-based effect is going to do is it basically goes from one step to the next in order, and then it loops back to the beginning. Now, each step is active for a certain period of time before moving on to the next step. This time is reflected in the column that's labeled step time. This is the actual time that elapses between each step. So if I'm looking at this right now, you can see the default time is 1 second. That means step 1 will be active for 1 second, then step 2 for 1 second, and so on and so forth. But our default times may not always suit what we're trying to do. We may need that to be a little faster or a little slower. So what we can do is go in to this column and change that time to something that will better suit our needs. So to do that, what I want to do is first select all 6 of my steps, and I'm going to use my mouse to get my step command down here at the bottom of the editor window, and I'm going to pick all 6 of my steps. Now I could pick each step individually if I wanted to create an effect that had kind of a random timing effect, but I want to speed up or slow down the entire effect, so I want to apply the same timing to all 6 of my steps. Once I have them selected, I can use the right arrow and move over to the column labeled step time. And for our purposes, I'm going to change this to 2 seconds. So I'm going to lengthen the effect. I'm going to double its length, essentially, so that each step gets 2 seconds to be active before moving on to the next. Now I'm going to leave the rest of the timing parameters alone, and we're going to go out to the live display and see what this looks like, because after all, once you make a change to the effect, you want to look at it and see if that's going to work for you. So let's look at live. And I will pick my six channels and play them in effect number one. And we can see now that each fixture, or each channel, gets 2 seconds in the spotlight, so to speak, before the next one takes over. So now we have taken this effect and made it run significantly slower. One other option the ion gives you is to modify the speed of this effect live while it's running. Let's take a look at how to do that. While the effect is running and I'm in my live display, I want to make sure I have a clear command line. So I'm going to hit clear as many times as I need to so that I have nothing on the command line and just a blinking cursor. And I'm going to hit the effect key one time. What this does is it opens up the effect playback status display. And this is a list of all the effects that are currently running on the desk. Also in this list are all of the parameters that I can edit. And you can see that on my effect number one, I have a blue 100 in the rate section. That indicates to me that I have the ability to change the rate of this effect. Now, rate is expressed in a percentage, and 100% is default speed. That's the speed that's set in the effect editor. Right now, we're running at 2 seconds. Anytime I have this display up, my encoders in my non-intensity parameter section of the console will actually be mapped to these commands. So if I look at my number four encoder, and I can see that that's mapped to the rate command. So all I have to do is turn that encoder to affect the rate of that effect, and I can speed it up very gradually until I find a speed that works perfectly for my application. Now, this is a lot simpler than going into the effect editor and putting in 1.25 or 1.26 seconds for each step, and then playing it back every single time to make sure that that's exactly what I want. I can simply run the effect live, turn my rate encoder, and match the speed to anything I want. And those are some ways that you can make some very common timing modifications to step-based effects on the ion. This section covers using effects in cues on the ion console. Now, one of the unique things about effects on the ion is that they are their own separate entity. They're not actually in a cue or in a sub until you put them there. Now, you put them there by actually making them a manual value. Just like I take channel 1, for instance, and I set it at 50%, that's a manual intensity value, I can take channel 1 and put it at effect number 1, which in a sense is still a manual value, but the effect itself will play back on that channel. So let's take a look at doing that. I have a very basic 6-step-based effect already recorded in my ion console, and I want to go ahead and play that back. So I'm going to take the 6 channels that are in that effect and put them to that effect as a manual value. So I select my channels, 1 through 6, and I want to run them at effect number 1. Enter. And now you'll see on our channel display that channels 1 through 6 are currently displaying a value of E1, and our virtual rig is showing us that we have a nice, simple chase running. Now, just like any manual value that I put into a cue, I simply have to record the cue in the state that the current stage looks like. And because the effect is a referenced information, the channel just knows to go to effect 1 whenever the cue plays back. So to get this to happen, I just record a new cue, record Q7, enter. And now you'll see that the values in Q7 reflect the fact that these channels are playing back at effect number 1. Now, the effect isn't in the cue. The effect still lives in the effect area of the console, and I can go back and change that. But anytime I play back this cue, channels 1 through 6 will go to that effect, whatever it happens to be. And we can see that in our cue sheet, where the effect 1 is indicated that it's going to be part of this cue in the external link column. What's also nice about this is any manual or live timing changes that I make to this effect are stored in the cue, not in the effect. So my base effect has the steps running at about 2 seconds. And if I, using my effect status display, change the rate of that effect to speed it up, and then update the cue, that new rate is stored with the cue, not in the effect. So I could actually use effect 1 in many different cues at many different rates. And that's how you would use effects in cues on the Ion console. This section is going to cover how to use patch on the Ion console. Now, to use patch, we need to go into the patch display. And to get to the patch display, we need to hit our displays key and soft key 3 to get into patch. Now, once we're in the patch display, we are looking at primarily just a table. And we are looking at the columns that give us all the information about how our patch is currently assigned. Now, the columns we want to pay particular attention to are all the way over to the left. And the channel column is the one that's currently all the way to the left. And then right next to that, we'll see a column for address. Now, if you remember on the Ion console, a channel is associated with a single device. Now, it doesn't matter if that device is a single parameter device like a dimmer or a multi-parameter device like a big moving light. A channel is still a channel. It's the number of addresses that are used in the channel that determine what the type of light is and how many items you need to control it. Now, every Ion console has a capacity of 5,000 channels, and depending on the Ion that you have, it's anywhere between 1,000 and 2,000 different addresses of control. So let's take a look at how we would assign an address to a channel. Now, in our default one-to-one patch setup, you can see that each channel is associated with a single address, and that single address happens to correspond to a dimmer. Now, there may be a time where I would like to have multiple dimmers functioning on one channel. What I first want to do is select the channel that I'm going to use, and in this case it'll be channel 1. And now I can hit the at key to assign the addresses. So my command line has already posted address, and now I can pick the address or addresses that I want to assign to channel 1. In this case, 1 through 3. So I push enter, and because these addresses are currently being used somewhere else, the console is prompting me if I would like to overwrite. And yes, I would. So I will press enter. And now you can see that channel 1 has been broken up into 3 parts, and each part has its own address. It's still channel 1. If I bring up channel 1 in my live display, channel 1 will still go on, but instead of bringing up just one dimmer, I will get 3 dimmers that come up with it. Now, if I wanted to change that back to a 1-to-1 patch, I could do that individually by taking channel 1 at address 1, 2 at 2, and 3 at 3. Or I could also type the syntax 1 through 3 at 1, enter, and it would do the same thing. It would just simply reset them all to a 1-to-1 patch. If you are used to typing your dimmers or your addresses first, the Ion lets you do that as well. So you can hit the format key, and that format key again is up in your display's keypad. And what this will do is reformat the display so that the address column is first. Now when you begin typing on the command line, you're actually starting with an address. So to do that same example, putting addresses 1 through 3 on channel 1, just as you would expect, I can type 1 through 3 because the console is assuming address. I hit the at key to assign a channel, select my channel number, press enter, override the warning, and now you can see that each address is assigned to channel 1 and the associated part of channel 1 that I want to do. Now, to go ahead and get those back to a 1-to-1, I can do them individually, or I can go back out to sorting by channel and do my original 1-to-1 command where I take all 3 of them, channels 1 through 3, at address 1, enter, and it will put them back to their original 1-to-1 assignment. And that's how you would use the patch to assign addresses to channels on the Ion console. Let's take a look at how we would patch a multi-parameter device on the Ion console. To do this, we need to go to patch. Hitting displays and soft key 3 will take us to patch. And we're looking at our typical 1-to-1 patch where we have channel per address, and then each device, which is a dimmer, only requires one address. Now, we know that if we add a scroller or an RGB LED color mixing type fixture or a moving light, that we are going to have a channel that will require many, many addresses to control all of those things together. So let's look at how the Ion console allows you to put a multi-parameter device into a channel. Let's start with the scroller. That's a nice simple example. And maybe I want to add a scroller to channel 7. Now channel 7 is just a regular old light that's in my theater, and it's got a dimmer to control its intensity, but I'm going to add a scroller on the front of that light. So now I will essentially have a two-parameter device, intensity and color. Well, the first thing I have to do is break channel 7 up into two parts so that I have a second part to attach the scroller to. So to do that, I just type 7 part 2, enter, and it will default to type dimmer, but I can change that. But notice that part 1 is still a dimmer and it's still assigned to address number 7. So I'm preserving my 1-to-1 intensity patch, but now I have an open part 2 ready for me to do something with it. Now, where do I do all of this assignment? Over in the CIA, once I get into patch, I have the programming section of patch available to me. And what you'll see on the far right-hand side of the patch display are a couple of buttons that have fields in them that I can change the information in that field. What I want to do here with part 2 is change the type. And you'll notice that it says type dimmer. Well, that's what I want to change. So I'm going to use my mouse and I'm going to click on type. And now I'm presented with a browser. And what I can do is browse through all of the different types of devices that I can patch in my Ion console. And in this case, I just want to put in a scroller. So what the console is going to do is default to a page where I can pick generic. On the left-hand side, I have manufacturers of equipment. And on the right hand side, I have all of the equipment that is manufactured by the manufacturer. So what I'm going to do first is just pick generic scroller, and I am finished. Now you can see over here in our patch table that I have part 2 has been changed from type dimmer to type scroller. And now all I have to do is assign an address to the scroller. This is where it gets a little interesting. Typically, when you add any kind of automated fixture, like a scroller or an RGB fixture or even a moving light, you're oftentimes using a different data line than is the one going to your dimmer racks. So typically, you have your port number 1 goes to your dimmer racks, and your port number 2 would go to any automated fixture. This is because any port, or DMX port, is the long-term port, is just really short for DMX port, is really only capable of 512 addresses at a time. If you happen to have 300 or 400 dimmers in your facility, you're using up the vast majority of all the addresses available to you on port number 1. So when you're patching in other automated fixtures or automated devices, it's a good idea to start them on port number 2 or port number 3 if you have it. Now to do this, I'm going to be using a syntax which is port and offset. So essentially what this means is I am going to specify the port where this device is plugged in and then the address. And to do this, I find the address field over here in my patch programmer and I can click in address. Now to choose a port, I simply type the port number, hit a slash, and then I type the address of the port. Now every port starts over at 1, so I can assign this scroller to the first address of the second port by typing address 2/1, and I push enter. And now you can see that in our table that I have a two-part channel. Part 1 is the dimmer, part 2 is the scroller. Now the interesting thing about the address for 7, it doesn't say 1/7, although when the 1/ is not there, you can assume that a plain old 7 is port 1, address 7. So now I have a scroller attached to that dimmer. And when I go out to my live display and grab channel 7, I have separate control of the intensity and separate control of the color. Now, if I wanted to patch in an RGB fixture, I would use a very similar method. But as you know, an RGB fixture is usually LED and does not need a dimmer associated with it. So I don't have to create another part all we have to do is change its type from a dimmer to this fixture. And let's do this with channel 8. So I want to go to channel 8. I want to hit type. I'm going to browse in my alphabetical manufacturer list to Color Kinetics. And maybe this is a Color Blast 12. So now I have a Color Blast 12. And I want to change its address to the second port. And maybe this unit is addressed at second port address 101. And the console has done the math for me. So I now know that my Color Blast 12 is channel 8. It's one channel, yet it's using three addresses. One for R, one for G, and one for B. Once I have all of these units patched, I can go out to live and start working with them. In this chapter, I'm going to cover how you would customize your scrollers on the Ion console. And to do that, we need to go to patch. So let's look at patch and hit displays, soft key 3 for patch. And let's look at our channel 7, which was previously assigned just a generic scroller. Now what a generic scroller allows you to do is have independent control of intensity on the wheel and where the scroll is from beginning to end using an encoder. But it doesn't necessarily let you decide to go to a specific frame, or the console may not understand how many frames are in your scroll. However, if I go into patch and I tell the console exactly what kind of scroller I'm using by manufacturer, and I also tell the console what gel I have in the scroller, the console can actually help me out by knowing how many frames are there, what color I can go to, and a couple of shortcuts in programming my scrollers. So let's look at that. What I want to do is change my Channel 7 Part 2 to a specific scroller as opposed to a generic scroller. To do that, I need to choose Channel 7 Part 2, go to Type over here in my editor, and now I can browse by manufacturer. And I'm going to browse the manufacturer list, and I happen to have a Vibron Coloram 2. So now I've changed from just plain old scroller to a Coloram 2. Now I've assigned the specific scroller. Now it's time to tell the console what color gel is in this scroller. To do this, I need to look at a different tab in my patch editor. And to change the tab in the patch editor, I want to look at the lower portion of the right-hand side of my patch editor. You'll see that there are three different tabs I can go to. They are backed by a gray backing, and the current one is highlighted in yellow, and right now I'm in patch, which is the default. What I want to do is go to attributes. So when I click on attributes with my mouse, I get a new set of fields available to me to edit, and the one I'm looking at is the one that's labeled scroller. So what I want to do is click in scroller, and once I do that, the left-hand side of my patch editor will become the scroll editor. And there are a few default scrolls that'll show up in there, but of course, the scroll that I want to put on is custom. So what I want to do is click New down at the bottom, and I can give it a label by clicking on Label. I'm going to label it Custom Scroll. And now when I want to drop in my colors, I simply go down to the command at the bottom that says Edit. And I have a list of frames. The frame table basically gives me a frame number, its name, and then an actual representation of the color of the gel that I've picked. All I have to do is click in that cell to make the change. And now I can browse through the different manufacturers of gel. And in our case, I'll just pick some commonly used ones. And when I'm finished dropping in my frames, I click Done. And now you will see that I have the custom scroll assigned to my scroller so that I know that I'm now using that scroll. So now what I've told the Ion console is that my light has a Coloram 2 scroller with these very specific gels in the scroll in a very specific order. So now I can use commands on the Ion console to go to a specific frame, or I can use the Ion console to help me match my color mixing units to a particular gel that I have in my scroller. And that's how you would customize your scroller setup on the Ion. In this section, I'm going to teach you how to use Park. Now, Park is a feature that allows you to set any channel or any address to a specific level and park it there. And as long as the console is turned on, that channel or address will be at that level. Now, one of the nice things about Park is that nothing else in the console can affect that channel once you've parked it. And channels or addresses that are parked are not recorded when you press the record key. Now, this is especially useful for a dimmer that you may want to have on at a specific level at all times as long as your console is turned on, like maybe backstage running lights. So let's take a look at how you will use Park on the Ion. There are two ways that you can park and unpark addresses and channels on the Ion. One, you can do it live, and the other you can do in the park display. Let's look at the live option first. Now, I will do this by typing in a command like I normally would to set a channel at a level. Maybe I want to park my channel 6 at 25% because channel 6 is some lights that I have set up backstage so that everybody can see what's happening backstage and they don't trip over scenery. So I just want this to be on at a very low level, say 25%. So what I want to do is type channel 6 at 25. And now what I want to do is hit the park key. And the park key is located in the frequently used command area above my command keypad. So my command line says channel 6 at 25 park. Now I push enter. And now channel 6 is parked at 25%. I can use the blackout, the grandmaster, a submaster, a queue. I can hit record. Nothing is going to change the fact that channel 6 is now parked at 25. Now you'll notice on the channel display that channel 6 has a small little P to indicate that channel 6 is parked. And also on my displays up in the upper left-hand corner, you'll see an indicator that we have parked channels on the console. Now to unpark that channel, I simply repeat the command, but I leave a level out. So I would say channel 6, park, enter, and the console will ask me if I want to confirm the unparking of that channel. I click enter one more time, and now channel 6 is unparked. I can do the same thing with address, and the way I get to a specific address is by using a soft key. Soft key 4 says address. And if I wanted to park an address, I would do exactly the same thing. Now remember that when you park a channel, you are parking a channel or a specific attribute of the channel. When you're parking an address, you are picking a specific address to park. Let's take a look at how you would park in the park display. Now to get to the park display, you simply double hit the park key. Now what's nice about the park display is that you will see all of the channels that you have currently parked. Now the park display is divided in half. The top half will show me any channels I have parked, and the bottom half will show me any addresses that I have parked. And to park channels and addresses, I follow the same syntax, but I don't have to hit the park key this time. So if I wanted to park channel 6 at 25, I just have to type 6 at 25, enter. And because I'm in this display, the channel is automatically parked. Same is true for address. Now the address soft key moves in this display over to soft key 1. So if I wanted to park address 205, I simply hit address 205 and I can type a level like at 50 and hit enter, and now you can see that I have address 205 parked at 50. Now the unpark command is the same as it is in live. So I can say address 205 park enter, and I can unpark the channel the same way, 6 park enter. I can confirm the unpark request by pushing enter, and channel 6 is now unparked. And those are the methods that you would use to park channels and addresses on the Ion console. In this chapter, I'm going to show you how to save and recall show files on your Ion console. All saving and recalling is done from the browser and the file menu within the browser. So let's take a look at that right now. I'm going to hit my displays key to make sure that my browser is active. And now I can use my arrow keys to navigate through the browser. And again, we're going to be working in the file menu. So the file menu is currently selected. I can hit the right arrow to expand out the options available to me in the file menu. And when you're saving your show for the first time, it's a good idea to create a new directory for that show and save it directly on the hard drive of the Ion console. And here's how you do that. I want to scroll down to save as, because save as is the default command for saving a brand new show file. And I can hit the right arrow to open that up. And what's going to happen is you'll be presented with the show file archive that I can open and close using the left and the right arrow. And all the way down at the bottom will be an option to create a new folder. Now, it's nice to create a new folder so you can keep your show file archive organized by maybe show title. Each time you save a show file, it actually creates a brand new file with a unique date and timestamp. Now, you shouldn't worry about saving it too many times. It's better to save often because the Ion has a very large hard drive and you can save thousands and thousands of shows before you'd even approach any kind of capacity issue. So it's better to save a lot, and it's also better to keep things organized so that you know where to go when you want to retrieve your shows. So let's create a new folder. Once I'm down on the new folder indicator, I can hit select. Anytime I hit select in the browser, I'm basically selecting that action for the console to perform. So I'm at new folder. I will hit select. The console is now asking me to create a new folder name. So this again is just the directory where the show is going to live, and I need to give it a title. So I will call this Training Show Fun. And I can press enter, and now I've created that particular show directory. So now, once I've created the directory, in the save as, I scroll down to that directory and click select, and the console will prompt me to make sure that I really want to save, and I can hit escape to cancel out of this, or I can hit select to finish the save process. And the first time I save a show file, it's going to ask for a name. So I'll give it a name and press enter. The console will give me a little dialogue telling me that it has saved the show and that it was a success. Now, I also have an option. In addition to saving onto the Ion hard drive, I can use the save as command to save to a small USB flash drive or a memory stick. Now, to do that, I take the drive and I can insert it into the USB port that's available to me on the front of my Ion. That's the most convenient location to put it in. Now, when I go to save as, I will get an option with the new drive showing up in its in place. The show file archive is technically the hard drive on the Ion console, and I have an F drive, which is telling me that it's this Kingston USB storage device. So now I can follow the same procedure. I can create a new folder here. And I can do exactly the same command. Now, in addition to using the arrows in the browser, you can also use your mouse. Sometimes it depends on if you're an arrow person or a mouse person. And double clicking or simply mousing over and clicking OK will do exactly the same thing. And the show will indicate that it has saved to my USB device successfully. Now, when I'm ready to open a show file, I simply use the file open command, doing the same thing. So I go to file, open, and I'm also presented with an option to browse my show file archive or to browse any of my external devices that I have plugged in. So I will just browse the show file archive. And I can see in my archive that I named Training Show Fun that I have the most recent save. I've only saved it one time, and I just double click on the show file. Show files end in .esf. Once you double-click on a show file, the Ion will alert you and let you know that you can read in only portions of that show. By default, the entire show will read in, but you can uncheck things that you don't necessarily want if you just want to read part of the show file. And when you've done that, you can click OK, and it will load the show. And you are ready to go. That is the method that you will use to save and recall show files on the Ion. All right, so it's been a long weekend of tech, and you are ready to finally shut down the Ion console and go home. So let's take a look at how you do that. Now, I know you might be tempted to just unplug it from the wall, but please don't. There are a couple of functions in the browser that we recommend you use to shut down your Ion console. They both achieve basically the same thing. There's one called Exit Ion. Now, what Exit Ion will do is take you out to the main startup menu, and there will be a shutdown button there. But for all of our convenience, there is a shortcut that just says simply power off the console. So in the browser, I can double-click on that with my mouse or scroll to it and hit select. The console will say, do you really want to power down the console? And of course, it's 3 o'clock in the morning and I say yes. So I hit select again and the console will power down. And that's how you power down your console. Over the course of using your Ion console, or even during the initial setup of your desk, you may need to access a couple of functions that aren't immediately available to you in the Ion operating software. Now, there is an area of the Ion console that runs in the background behind the actual Ion console, and that's called the shell. And you'll need to get to the shell to do things like set the time and date of your console. Now, it's important to remember that when you go into the shell, your Ion console is not functioning as a console. So make sure you do this command only when you don't need your console to be running anything on your stage. So let's take a look at how we would get into the shell. We do this from the browser, and we're going to use the exit ion command. Now you'll notice that we also have a power off console command, and that will just power down the console. That does not take you to this area called the shell. So we really do want to use the exit ion. So I will hit select once I have that highlighted. The console will prompt me to make sure that I really do want to quit the program, and I can either use my mouse to click OK or hit select again to exit the Ion program, and now I'm in the shell. What the shell allows me to do is by clicking on these buttons, I can decide a couple of things. First, I can decide how I want the console to boot up. Now, typically we boot up into primary, and that simply means that the console acts like a console. It's the primary device. But I can also boot up my Ion console into backup mode, where it will literally back up another Ion or even an EOS console. I can start up the Ion into client, which will enable the Ion to be a client of another Ion or an EOS. Or I can boot up my Ion into offline mode. And what offline mode will do is start up the console just like normal, so I can program, but it doesn't output any DMX, so I can program without affecting anything live. I also have the option to shut down the console from the shell using the shutdown key. But we also want to take a look at this key called settings, and what settings will do is open up another window in the shell, and this window is divided up into submenus or tabs, and this is where you can do some commonly used functions in the shell. So starting at the top, we want to cover some of those commonly used functions or commonly performed tasks. And in the startup tab, what we can do is define how we want the console to start up by default. Typically it's left as primary, but I can tell my Ion console to start up in any one of the modes available to me. Or I can even uncheck the show welcome screen at startup so that the console just automatically boots into Ion without showing me the shell first. In my general tab, this is a tab where you might be spending quite a bit of time as you're setting up your console, because this is where I can give my console a name, I can set the time and date of the console, and even change the language of the console. In the general tab is also where I can tell the Ion how I have my monitors initially set up. One other area of the settings window that I might want to go to is the maintenance tab. Now, typically, you would be asked to go to the maintenance tab by ETC Technical Services if you call them with questions about your Ion. And this is where you will do things like deep clear the console to set it back to its factory defaults, save some of the show logs if you need to report something to Technical Services, the console can save a history of commands that you've done on the console, or do things like manage your show files. All of the other tabs and settings on the Ion are pretty much best left in their default setting, because these default settings will generally work for the majority of Ion users. However, if you know that you need to make a change in one of these settings in one of the other tabs, it's best to consult your Ion user manual or just contact ETC Technical Services directly to get your answers to some questions there. Now, once you're finished using the settings area, I can either click accept if I've made any changes, or I can click cancel, and that will take me back out to my main shell window. And I can click primary to boot up into the Ion software. And once the console runs through its boot up procedure, we'll be ready to go. In this section, you will learn how to print information from the Ion console so that you can review it later on your laptop, share it with others, or even print it on your home or office printer. So let's take a look at that. All of the printing functions on the Ion are available from the browser in the menu called Print. So let's look at that. I'm going to hit Displays to get my browser active and scroll down to Print. And the option I have in the Print menu when I expand that out is the option to print to file. Now, what the Ion will allow you to do, rather than print to a physical printer that you hook up to your console, it will print to an interactive PDF. Now, what's great about the interactive PDF is that it allows you to sort through information very quickly. So say, for instance, I'm looking at the section of the printout that is showing me the submaster list. The submaster list will actually contain hyperlinks that will take me to more detailed information about the submaster that I click on. So when I decide to print to a file, I first have to decide where I want to print it to. I can print to the Show File Archive, which again is the hard drive that's built into the Ion console, or if I had a USB storage device plugged into the desk, I would see that drive letter showing up there as well. But the way you do this is the same in either case. So what I want to do is choose the location where I'm going to print and hit Select. Then the console will present me with a screen that allows me to remove information from the printout. By default, it's going to print out everything in the show, and the list is quite extensive. But I can, from this display, deselect items that I don't want. Maybe I don't want cues or my patch. Then I can simply click OK, and I give the file a name, and press Enter. And the console will take that information and export it to a PDF. Now that PDF is located in the Show File Archive under the Print menu or on the appropriate drive letter for my USB storage device. Then I can take that file and bring it to my office or my home and print it out from my personal computer. That's how you will print information from the Ion console. This section is going to cover how to clear your show or just portions of your show. This is all accomplished in the browser under a menu called Clear. So let's take a look at that. Make the browser active, scroll down to Clear, and I can press Select or double click with my mouse. And the Ion is going to present me with a top menu that allows me to clear large portions of the show, reset things to defaults, or even reset my patch 1-to-1. So you'll want to use this option fairly carefully and make sure that you're doing what you want to do. One of these options in here that I want to direct your attention to is something called Clear Targets, because what this allows you to do is get a little bit more specific about what you want to clear, because you can actually go in and clear just your subs, just your cues, just your groups, and start from scratch with those and leave the rest of the show intact. Once you decide what you want to clear and click OK, you're ready to begin anew. And that's how you clear your show or just parts of your show on the Ion. In this section, I'm going to cover some of the more commonly used features in the Setup option menu of the Ion. Now, the Setup menu contains a lot of functionality. And for more detail on all the things that we don't cover, you might want to consult your user manual. But for now, we're going to cover some of the most commonly used features and where to find them. So let's take a look at that right now. To get to our setup display, what we want to do is hit Displays, and we can hit Soft Key 4 to get into Setup. And there are two primary areas that we want to focus on. We want to focus on Desk Setup and Show Setup. So let's first start with a little bit of Desk Setup. And the way to get to Desk Setup is my Soft Key number 2 will say Desk, so I want to push that. And now our CIA is going to show us all of the options available to us to set up our desk. Now what we can do in here is by selecting from the buttons along the left-hand side, we can go to different sub-menus of the desk setup menu. These are places where I can change things like my record default, which is the first button. I can change manual control, which is where I can change like a default time. Like if I wanted my default sneak time to be a little bit quicker than 5 seconds, like 3, I could simply click in the area that says sneak, enter a new time, press enter, and I can update the time that way. This is also where I can change my default level. Remember, level is by pushing full. And I can also change my plus percent and my minus percent. Also here, there is a submenu called Face Panel Keypad. This is something worth knowing because this is where I can enable and disable my Blackout and Grandmaster if I don't want to run the risk of using one of those in the middle of a show. Let's take a look at show settings. So I'm going to hit soft key 1 to look at the show menu of the setup. And my submenus, the first one that comes up will be show settings. This is where I can change things like the number of channels I need to use. Remember, your Ion console is capable of 5,000 channels, but if you don't need that many right now, you can simply click in that field, enter a new number like 1,000, click enter, and now the Ion will display up to 1,000 channels. I can also look at queue settings and change all of my default queue times. If you remember, when you record a new queue in the Ion, it automatically puts in these default times, so you can change them from 5 seconds to anything else that you may feel appropriate for your programming needs. And then one area we want to spend a little bit more time on is this area called fader configuration, because what fader configuration allows you to do is just like it sounds. It allows you to configure how the faders are set up if you have fader wings attached to your Ion console. So let's look at the fader configuration display and explain how to use that. So I'm going to go into fader configuration, and we're taken to a whole new display. Now what we're looking at is a matrix, essentially, of sliders and functions. Across the top, we will see indications for a bank of 10 sliders. Now if you notice on your fader wings, all of the sliders are in groups of 10. So what you're doing is you're configuring 10 at a time. Now each slider can be individually configured, but in this display, we're looking at 10 sliders per page. What I can do is decide what each slider's function is going to be. I can choose from, and I'm reading down here the far left-hand column, I can choose from submaster, where the fader will just be a regular sub. It can be a playback as an auxiliary playback fader in addition to my main playback fader. I can map 2 additional grandmasters to my auxiliary fader wings, or I can simply leave the fader unmapped and I can save it for later if I want to. So to change it, all I have to do is click in the appropriate box that represents the function that I want it to do. Maybe I can change these from playbacks to submasters. And all the way down at the bottom, I want to make sure that the appropriate submaster number is selected. Remember, up at the top portion, all I'm doing is deciding what the function of the slider is. The bottom portion, I have to decide the actual record target. So I want to make sure that I have the right submasters in there. I can pick any submaster in the system, but typically it's going to start with the lowest number and work its way up in group of 10. I click OK and close. And I have just configured my first bank of 10 faders. And those are some of the more commonly used features of the setup menu on the Ion. I hope you've enjoyed this training program and now feel inspired to explore the Ion and its capabilities even further. Good night and good luck.